At last, we have this video up and rolling. Welcome to this video. Let me set the scene for you here so you know what you're getting into. For those who are really focused on super positivity training, which is the essence, the hard essence of what we all need to do, I have videos that specialize in that. This one is a little bit different. I'm going to try and weave an overall theory of what's going on, overall context for us to understand. So it may not be leaning, you know, it's not solid super positivity training here. There's some talk about the world, what's going on, what to expect, a lot of stuff here. So just be aware of that. Now, this information we're going to go over here has to do with what's called Planet X, Nibiru, that sort of stuff. To a certain extent, we're going to look at that. Now, the overall zeitgeist of the world in terms of this issue and it is so difficult, so much misinformation, so much confusion. I don't advise you trying to dig into it unless you're an expert. And I call myself an expert on this. A lifetime of expertise focusing in on the overall big issues and context. I know how to do it. So sometimes rely on the experts. Like if you want some pictures from the top of Mount Everest, let the Sherpa guides go up there and take the pictures, you know, and come back. Or, you know, I tend to let the experts deal with what they're expert at. I mean, this is just very, very smart thing to do. And I can tell you, I haven't even paid attention to this whole thing for quite some time because the amount of confusion and emotionalism and misinformation, etc., is just hideous. There's nothing more intense than this issue, really, in terms of how do you see it clearly. Now, so I've stayed away from it. I pretty much know what's going on. Always have. I've done a massive amount of work on this. So, and again, expertise, the thing is that scientists, they define expertise in a way which makes them seem expert and makes people like me seem non-expert. But they're the ones making the rules and definitions of what an expert is. So you can't rely on that. The scientists are so narrowly focused that they're not really capable of seeing the big picture context at all. My whole expertise is in big picture context. Context is everything. It's so important. And so I'm an expert at that. They're not. And that's just all there is to it. So hold on, so here comes someone, just a minute. Hi. Yeah, we're busy right here right now? Okay, thank you. Okay. Interesting. A yoga girl with a dog just walked up here and tried to interrupt me what I was doing. All perky in her yoga outfit with a dog and everything. Wow, very interesting. So, the context is so important. You have to have this very wide open ability. Okay, and this takes compassion. You have to have tremendous compassion to have this. So here, we do not go after anybody. We're not mean-spirited. We're not trying to attack. You know, the fact of the matter is that everybody has the same goal. We want to be happy. All right? We want to enjoy life. We want to enjoy happiness. We're all after that. Everyone is. The scientists are after it. The elites are after it. Everyone. But they go at it after it in different ways, depending on various factors. So we are not on a witch hunt. We are not trying to blame anybody. You know, none of that. It's compassion. Let's get to the truth. Let's help everyone. This is the right context. And when you have this context, you're much more wide open and you become more aware, okay, than others who are in this, you know, us against them dualistic dichotomy. They're the ones who are so confused. So if you dive into all this confusion, I mean, you just don't know. Your mind just becomes so disturbed. It is brutal. So I don't advise doing that unless you yourself are an expert at the wide open compassion and know how to not get caught up in this, but it is nasty. And to set the scene here a little bit, I was at the store a couple days ago at nighttime, and I believe I may have mentioned this that in a previous video. There's somebody right standing beside, came out of the store, standing beside the car, and we're right parked beside them. And he's right there, and I just say hi. You know, he seems like want to say something, so hi, and then we chat a little bit, you know, just casual chat, and then it gets more and more and more and more and more, and then he has something very important he wants to tell me, and he says, "You got to look up this musician. You got to look up this musician. You got it. You got it. You got it. You got it." I said, "Wow, why? What's going on here?" So I looked up the musician, and he is the member of a band called Planet X. It's like, wow, okay. Now, it is also true that the synchronicity of God's grace has been absolutely inundating me with warnings about trouble coming, incoming rocks, and various troubles that you would associate with Planet X, actually. I can't get away from it. I don't want to pay attention to it because there's so much. It's so much confusion. I just want to ignore it, like most other people in the world. We don't want to believe that there's trouble. Who wants to believe there's trouble? I mean, the scientists, they want to have their nice car, house, family, vacations, restaurants, lifestyle. You know, I want to just like play golf and take some beautiful pictures and just hang out and just, you know, just enjoy life. Who doesn't want to enjoy life? We don't want to believe that there is this planet, this mass, this terrible destroyer planet, disturber, wrecking ball, you know, nemesis planet that comes around every so often through our solar system. Who wants to believe that? Nobody does. Nobody does. I don't either. But facts are facts, and it's easy to ignore the facts if you don't want to believe in it. So what I have found is there's a very strong collective desire that this planet, actually Nibiru, doesn't exist. Okay, and we believe by just ignoring the facts that through some sort of sympathetic magic, the ostrich stick their head in the sand, that it won't exist. That it just doesn't exist because we say it doesn't. This is a very, very powerful type of human psychology of something that is so terrible you don't want it to exist, is just ignore it and it'll go away, right? This is what I have found is at play here. It's very seductive. People say, "No, I just want to enjoy my life. I don't want to think about that." You know, just so therefore, anyone thinks about it, it's a crackpot, a kook. Well, guess what? That is ostrich sticking their head in the sand. I don't know if ostriches do that, but you get the idea. It's a type of defense reaction they have. If you've really, really dug into all this, which I have to the ultimate extent, you know that there is trouble. There is trouble in the cosmos, okay? There's no question about it. It's 100% slam dunk true that there certainly has been cosmological trouble in the history of this planet periodically, and to such an extent, and it's been so terrible that the people who lived through it, who went through it, passed on this information, those who survived, passed it on collectively, it was in a collective like consciousness, a memory, and talked about it and focused on it to an extreme extent. And it was so traumatic, it really formed like a whole complex, personality complex around it. Now, one of my specialties, I have a lot of them. When you're a great generalist, you have a lot of subspecialties that you've really looked into. And one of them is, of course, religion and the history of religion, and why do we have the various rituals and beliefs that we have. It doesn't really add up. If you know what truth is, then these religions, you say, what are they about? They're not really about truth. So what are they about? It's very like Christianity, not Catholic, but Christianity in general, the way that it's being presented. What is that about, really? It's not about what Jesus has to say. No, it is not. So it's very puzzling, isn't it? So a couple days ago, I was able to make this breakthrough connection. I said, oh my gosh, there's no question that the Holy Spirit wants me to look at Planet X and say, take a look at this again. Okay, so I said, all right, we'll do that. But this time, I saw it in a wider context than before. Now, a little background. It's very confusing. Planet X is here is the theory, okay, that is likely to be true, is that we live in a binary star system, Okay, we have our sun, that's a star, that's an active star, and we have a brown dwarf, which is an inactive star. It's a star that didn't quite activate. That doesn't mean it doesn't have properties and doesn't give off heat and all this stuff, but it's like a dark star. It's a brown dwarf. You can't see it very easily at all. This is, and scientists have said, wow, there's a lot of binary star systems out there we didn't know about. And they fluctuate between, most of them are, and maybe now it's like one out of every six or something. And they go back and forth like scientists always do. You know, someone says this is it, and someone says no, it isn't, and they argue for a while, and it goes on and on and on like that. But recently, scientists have said, yeah, there's this huge planetary body of some sort, gaseous, we're not sure what it is, it could be a brown dwarf outside of, you know, the farthest planet outside of, what was it, Pluto or something, and it's very large, like four times the size of Jupiter or something like that. And they're coming more and more and more around to the general consensus that there is something out there, and it could very well be a brown dwarf. Well, I say it is a brown dwarf, okay. There are many who realize that we live in a binary star system. Now, like the sun has planets going around it, orbiting around it, brown dwarfs also have planets going around. This is something that scientists are focusing in on. Do brown dwarfs have planets? And they say they're starting to find them. Yes, they do. Okay, so we say, okay, so this has planets going around it. Now, there's also an issue, a question. Are there planetary bodies, or is it possible there's orbital patterns that go around both stars in a binary star system? In long orbits, right? It'd be a long orbit. Well, we used to think that those long orbits don't exist. Well, the comet Hale-Bopp was like a 4,000-year orbit or something. We realized, yeah, they do. Long orbits are possible, absolutely. So, the cutting through all the confusion, Planet X is it's being used both to refer to the brown dwarf and to a planet that is orbiting the brown dwarf, but really orbiting both the sun and the brown dwarf. That's the nemesis. That's Nibiru, they call it. Ancients called it Nibiru. Wormwood, nemesis, the winged planet. Many, many terms throughout ancient history for this. And the ancients just were obsessed with cosmology and the heavens. Like they were constantly on the lookout for something. It is amazing the focus and obsession the ancients had about the sky. Just astonishing to us. And there's reasons for this. There's reasons for this. So what we're saying is that Nibiru is a planet. It's not a brown dwarf. It's a planet. Planetary body that is not easily visible. It tends to only be seen in infrared spectrum. I'm not exactly sure why that is. It gives a lot of iron oxide, tends to come off of it, and gives a reddish tint to it. So when it comes in through the solar system, it's the red planet, and it has wings like a planet with wings. You've seen these planet with wings. This is the winged disc is a very popular motif in history, and this could very well refer to this planetary body that is orbiting in an orbit around both our sun and the brown dwarf in our binary star system. Okay, so hopefully that clears up some of the confusion. The brown dwarf is not going to come through our solar system. That's very unlikely that's the scenario. It's out there. It's way out there. See, this is the thing that scientists say, yeah, we discovered this planet, a brown dwarf maybe, but it's so far away, it couldn't possibly have this strong effect on our solar system. So all you guys talking about Planet X are nuts. You know, they try to dismiss it like that. Well, that's not what's being said here. They're attacking a straw man argument entirely. What we're saying is there is a planetary body that is in this elliptical orbit around both the brown dwarf and our sun, which is called, we call it Nibiru. That's the real Planet X that people have been talking about. We give it the Nibiru, Wormwood, the Destroyer, Winged Planet, what nemesis, whatever you want to call it, Cosmic Wrecking Ball, a lot of different terms. So that should clear up a lot of the confusion. And this is the long orbital elliptical orbit. It takes like 3,600 years or so to complete one orbit. It's inclined, like our planets are on kind of a a plane, right? As the planets circle around the sun, they're on a plane. Well, this one comes at an angle to our the plane of our planet, so it comes up, sort of breaks the plane of our elliptic there as it goes through. Now, historically, there's a massive amount of evidence for this. Massive amount of evidence. Through all cultures, all lands, all over the planet. Going back into ancient history. So, if you really, really have dug into it, you realize it does exist, but then why the trouble we're having right now? And this is a really interesting story that I will tell. Certainly, if we take just a second before we jump into that, certainly we know, and it's pretty much indisputable, that the elites and power structure of this planet are preparing for some terrible catastrophe by the massive amount of underground construction they're doing. They have these huge tunnel bores that are gigantic, nuclear, run by nuclear power, using heat to melt the rock, and they provide these, they build these huge, smooth, glassy-like tunnels underground. Massive cities, 10 to 15,000 people or more underground. All the countries, the major superpowers, are doing this. The seed banks, the emergency food. It is, you know, nobody's really disputing all of that. I mean, there's too much evidence that there's these huge building projects underground. Why? There's no question that the elites are very jittery, very, very jittery. And you also have the issue of global warming and that huge dispute over that, which is a contextual dispute, really, between those who feel that the warming that's happening to the Earth is actually proven to be happening to all the planets in the solar system at the same time. And it's because, well, this is the question. Why is it? Why is it? And here is where it gets confusing. So that, sure, there's anthropocentric warming taking place on the planet a little bit, but that's not the sole reason for the warming of the planets. Now, some say it's the brown dwarf, some say it's planet X, Nibiru. When Nibiru approaches, it's a very large planetary body, actually, and it's extremely strong magnetic plasma effects, and it sends out gravitational waves, and it changes the solar system. The solar system is definitely changing. Others say, well, it's the brown dwarf, but you know, if the brown dwarf is so far away and it's a star, it's not really in an orbital pattern, is it? You know, this is a question, which is a bit of a slippery slope. So, this is one of the things they're not really clarifying for everyone. But let us just say that, let's say Nibiru, this planetary body that goes through the solar system, is coming into the solar system. And as it passes these planets, it has an effect, and it has an advanced shockwave effect on other planets. It's heating up this planet. A lot of volcanism, undersea volcanism, is taking place here that's not being reported. And you get global warming is happening throughout the solar system. Absolutely it is. The sun is being affected by all of this. So this is the theory, the context of that there's a division in the world. Is this warming being totally man-made, or is it also because of cosmological influences, primarily that way? And science would really back up the truth that it's cosmological. Most of it's cosmological. We're not saying that warming isn't happening. It is happening, but the causes of it are you know, is what the dispute really is. And there's so much money to be made out of blaming it on anthropocentric warming, man-made warming. So much massive profits to be made that people, greedy people, are pushing this agenda, and they have their greedy scientists, you know, their puppets, saying all this stuff. Because if it's being caused by Nibiru, you know, this is a whole different story, isn't it? Yeah, carbon credit, all this stuff is not really going to make any difference. And they want to get filthy rich so they can continue to build their underground cities in time and survive. You know, it's survival. People want to survive. They want their families to survive. They want to, you know, they don't want to go through the travails. So, you know, more power to everyone. Whatever their objective, however they go about anything. We're not going to try to lay a guilt trip upon anyone. Now, historically, let's go back historically. That there's no question that there were extreme traumas inflicted upon this planet, the people of this planet, periodically throughout very ancient history, and they were cosmological in scope. And the indications, the records are very clear that it talks about some perturber, some winged planet flying in through the solar system, and that affecting the planet in a drastically terrible way. Now, scientists won't really say that has never happened. What they say is it can't be a periodic, reoccurring thing. That's what they're telling us. You know, they want everyone to not panic. They say, just, you know, everything's fine, don't worry, nothing to see here, as the elites are frantically building underground installations in Stocky to be it right. Nothing to see here. So the issue is the periodicity of this. Does it reoccur? Now, of course, nobody wants it to reoccur. Nobody's saying, yeah, I hope it really comes, and very few are saying that. We don't want it to reoccur. But if it is this cosmological, if it is an orbit, then it certainly will reoccur, no matter what we think, no matter what we do, it will reoccur. Now, to the ancients who suffered through this, whose ancient ancestors had suffered through it and passed the information's passed down, they didn't want it to occur. I mean, if you really lived through the effects of this passing, planet of the crossing, it's often called, the Nibiru, planet of the crossing, means planet of the crossing, and Akkadian or ancient Sumerian, the effects of it passing can be devastating. It depends where it passes through the solar system. It doesn't always affect us so badly. It always has some effect, but sometimes are worse than others. Sometimes are much worse than others. The magnetic interaction with the Earth, the gravitational interaction, the debris field, massive debris field of millions and millions of miles, the Earth gets pelted with rocks, and the Earth burns, the oceans are pulled out of their basins, there's floods, tsunamis, gigantic earthquakes, you know, the atmosphere is disturbed, you go through, it is chaos for a while, it is really chaos, and then after that, they call it a new age dawns, where we realize we have another, you know, 3,600 years of peace and tranquility. So we talk about this new age that's coming in the world after the tribulation. The Bible talks about it very clearly. They'll go through a terrible tribulation period, and after that, a new age will dawn, okay? And the thing about the elites is, they believe that they're going to be the ones to populate the new earth, okay? So they're planning on having a somewhat extended stay underground. I was shown the future of this world in a dream, like a movie-like type of sequence, where I was shown what's going to happen. And what I saw was, after the tribulation of the planet, when things calmed down, all these people started coming out from underground. There's been a massive amount of people living underground that had taken refuge from this tribulation. And like termites coming from underground in the springtime, they're just, there's these various underground entranceways open up, and all these people start flooding out of these. I said, wow, what in the world? Also, I saw people arriving here in spaceships from other places, and then they populated this new planet and brought out what they call a new age, a millennial age of science, technology, bio, terraforming the planet, and they have all these seed banks, and I saw them planting all these trees and shrubs and everything, and they replanted, they were working on replanting the whole world. I literally saw all this as if I had been taken into the future and seen all this. And it's, this is what there are these self-selecting people who feel that they are the ones who are going to populate, they and their children and grandchildren will be the ones who bring about this new age here in this world after the tribulation. Now, in the Bible, it says Jesus talks about this great tribulation at the end of this age. The ages are pretty much calculated. I know there's the astrological calculation, but they're pretty much pragmatically calculated by the passage of Nibiru through the solar system, because it brings about catastrophic change here. And then once it's gone, everything settles down, and it's a new world order. The world has been reordered in a lot of ways. It's different. So, you know, the poles may flip. I mean, the Egyptians talk about, ancient Egyptian records talk about the sun rising in the west and setting in the east. Two times it's flip-flopped. In other words, maybe four catastrophes. It's this way, then it flipped from west to east, and went back to east to west, and west to east, and now back to east to west again. And it's very ancient records, Egyptian records. And there's, you know, there's a change of direction, rotation, there's pole shifts, there's all sorts of stuff that can happen, actually. And has happened historically. But not always, not always. Sometimes it's relatively mild. So I've been shown that this is what's going to happen. So the people here are certainly preparing. Now, they may not know how bad it's going to be, but the Bible says this one that is coming, the next one to come, is what Jesus was talking about. He says it's going to be the worst ever. In fact, he said, if those days weren't cut short, no living thing would survive upon the face of this earth. This is what, at least in the Bible, it's reported as Jesus saying. And maybe somebody put words in his mouth based on their own calculations and understandings, but maybe not. But anyway, it is supposedly going to be a very bad passing, which is why, you know, the leads are saying, taking their chances, I think we better, you know, 2 miles in a granite mountain, right? They have a lot of advanced technology to grow food underground. There's energy sources there, and they'll be able to survive there. And what I was shown, taking the future, they did survive. They did survive. But on the surface, no. It was really very, very intense stuff taking place. Now, so this is traumatic. When this Nibiru crosses the plane of the ecliptic and goes past the Earth, it can bring devastating consequences, so much so that it leaves massive global trauma in the psyche of everyone here, as you might well imagine. So, what they're focused on in terms of their happiness, they're saying, you know what? How can we be happy in a world where this kind of stuff happens? We've got to find a way to stop this from happening. We don't want this to ever happen again. All right, so this is pretty easy to understand. Anyone would feel that way. So they have certainly undertaken massive efforts to prevent it from happening again. What do you think is one of the biggest efforts ever undertaken to prevent the Nibiru from ever returning, or if it returns, to be entirely benign? What do you think one of the biggest efforts in history has been? It's called the Christian religion, is what it's called, actually. Hello. Hello, hello, hello. Yeah. Now, I have said that this existence is a cosmological dream of absurdity. It's based on a desire to be greater than God. And it's really a sacrificial dream, trying to get rid of God by bit by bit by bit by bit, killing off God, because we're afraid of awakening from this dream, thinking that when we awaken without a dream, we will have no creation, so we'll be nothing. See, we're trying to be a new prime creator, separate from God and be a new prime creator, spiritually. And to do that, all we can do to give evidence that we're a new prime creator is to dream. And so we've dreamed this cosmological dream, and that's the only evidence there is. But it's only evidence to us. It's not evidence to reality at all. So we think if we stop dreaming this cosmological dream, that we will have no creation. So how can we be a creator? We can't. And then we think, well, if we're not a creator, and since we separated from God, then we'll be annihilated. There'll be abyss. So we have this terror of awakening from the dream that we're dreaming. Of course, it's ridiculous because, as I've said many times, the dreamer is still exactly the same as when they started dreaming. The dream doesn't change them at all. And so we'll realize that we're pure causation in pure reality, you know, that we're not, there's zero abyss at all. But once, as long as we're dreaming, we don't quite see that clearly, and we think we'll be annihilated. So we want to avoid awakening from this dream at all costs. We want to empower non-awakening. This is what we do. Very absurdist. So we engage in absurdity and defending absurdity. So our psyche, our mindset is such that when we are met with like these catastrophes in this cosmological dream, we don't suddenly get enlightened and wake up from the dream. We say, huh, we got to find a way to stop this from happening again. And then within our absurdist context, we try to figure out a way. So what we have done is we have claimed that there's a God that we can approach that is responsible for this cosmological dream, the planets and all this stuff, and that we can somehow find a way to influence this God and say, like saying, and we what we imagined, okay, so we can have control. We're trying to control the cosmos, all right? It's like a dream figure trying to control the dream is what we're trying to do. Instead of realizing that we're just dreaming all this, they say, no, there's a dream figure, and they're the ones who have to control the dream. It's ridiculous, but this is what's going on. So they say, how do we control this planet from not coming back? And they say, well, let's say that it's being sent here by God. God sends it intentionally as a punisher for our sins, all right, for our wickedness, for our bad, from all the anger, the jealousy, the covetousness, and, you know, it goes on, deceitfulness and treachery and viciousness and killing and, you know, all these inner conflict that we have, which comes from absurdity, trying to be greater than God, comes from fear. It's all fear-based. We're crazy, you know. I mean, the dream is a crazy dream. It's very psychotic in our mentality, within absurdity. Very, very crazy stuff. So we have much to think that we're very bad, you know. Oh, we're so sinful. So we imagine that this sin is angering God, and that God is punishing us. Now, because we figure out, you know, sometimes I can control my anger, and I'm ready to strike, and I don't. This is, you know, humans, the interactions we have in this dream, these dream figures, are projecting fear and anger, and then feeling they're attacked, and then they're attacking others. And then sometimes we feel ready to strike in anger, and then we say, wait, you know, maybe this little grace of God comes to us. We say, you know what? Maybe it's not the best thing to do, when we don't do it. So we don't take vengeance. We don't punish sometimes. And we thought, hey, so we projected, you know, these qualities of our confusion onto this creator of the universe, cosmic God, and said, you know what? God's just like us. We think, and therefore we say, you know, sometimes God may be ready to strike us, and then God will say, wait a minute. I think I'm not going to do that. So we felt that this planet coming through, wreaking havoc in this world, was God wreaking vengeance and punishing us for our terrible sins, which deep down we feel guilty. We think, oh, we separated from God. We're trying to be a new prime creator. God's angry at us, so God wants to punish us. You know, there's this stuff is going in our psyche and influences our decisions and the logic and thinking very strongly, extremely strongly, and we don't even realize it. So we attribute, arrogate all these qualities to God, but God doesn't have it all. God's not, as Jesus said, God's not a designer of universes. We're the one who dreamed up this universe as a separate creation. And so God has nothing to do with sending planets and to destroy it, to punish us or anything, nothing. But we wanted to control this planet. So he said, you know, if we can say that someone is sending this planet like a weapon to harm us, and we can get on their good side, then they won't send it. Okay, you get this? Very simple and basic stuff, right? It's not difficult to understand. Once you get into the psychology of absurdity, this is how it thinks. So they said, okay, so God is angry at us, is saying us to punish it. So we'll go to God and say, God, we're really sorry for our sins. We're really sorry what we're doing. What can we do, you know, to be on your good side? Okay, this is the gist of it. Now, again, in human history, we know that there's been so many wars and invasions, and whatever your neighbor has, you know, the neighbor wants to get it from you. You want to get to what they have and, you know, benefit from the fruits of their labor, and you don't want to have to do all this hard labor yourself. Maybe if you go attack them and take, you know, defeat them militarily, you can take everything. That's been going on forever. So we covet stuff, precious stuff, stuff that we really want. And we don't want others to take it. We want to protect it. You know, we want to protect it. We don't want anyone to take it. It's very important. Now, we project this upon God too. We think that God, you know, maybe we have stuff that God wants. See, this is very key. We say, you know, just like our neighbors over there, our neighbors like are hostile to us because we have stuff our neighbors want, really precious jewels and all this, you know, various things, whatever it may be. And our neighbors come and attack us to take this away because they want it. And then we think, maybe God's like that. Maybe we have stuff that's precious and God really wants it. And if we just give this to God, say, God, here, it's yours, God will say, oh, that's nice. Now, let's say there's two neighboring kingdoms, and they both are wealthy, and they covet the wealth of the other nation. And one's about to attack the other. And now there's diplomats say, hey, wait a minute, you know, we don't want to be attacked. Maybe we'll lose the war. So we say, let's go on a diplomatic mission to the king, the warrior king of this other kingdom, and say, chief, let's sit down and let's talk about this. And say, what is it that you want? What do we have that you want so much? Do you want to attack us? And the king will say, well, you know, all the cattle and, you know, all the textiles and all the, you know, the jewels and, you know, whatever. And you say, yeah, okay, king. And they say, well, listen, king, we've got a big army too. And if you attack us, we're going to defend ourselves to the utmost, and we're going to wipe out, you know, as much of your army as possible. And then we're going to try to attack you as well later on. And this is going to be a real terrible war, king. But I'll tell you what, you know, maybe we can avoid this. I'll tell you what, we're going to give you like a third of the wealth of our kingdom, you know, all this massive, you know, booty that all the slaves have gathered throughout so long. We're going to pay tribute to you, to your greatness, to your powerfulness, by giving you this stuff, and in turn, you will not attack us. Okay, now, if you look at ancient history, this is what happened. This is what happens. It's called tribute to a powerful king. The powerful king gets tribute from the neighboring countryside, neighboring kingdoms. In exchange, the king does not attack them. You got this? This is history. This is the human psychology, psychotic psychology, the psychology of absurdity. Arrogance and absurdity and continuity fear. All of this is in play. This is how it works out. So the king says, you know, that's pretty cool. Yeah, I don't have to fight this terrible bloody war, and I can get all this treasure free, not doing anything, just by intimidation. And so the king says, yeah, I like that. No war. Okay, we'll live in peace for a while. And everybody goes, oh, this is great. You know, diplomacy has worked. So we project this model onto to this the so-called cosmological God, which we think is pulling the strings of all planets and stars and everything, and has sent this destroyer planet to punish us throughout history. We say, hey, you know, maybe we have something that this God wants, that if we give tribute to this God, the God will say, oh, okay, I'm not so wrathful anymore. I'm not so angry. I got what I really wanted with that. I don't even have to send the planet to punish you, so I won't send it this time. So what we did is we started this plan of sacrifice. It's called sacrifice, animal sacrifice, this kind of sacrifice, holy sacrifice to God in temples and such, dedicated to that. And we're saying, and what we do is say, God, we're going to take our best livestock, our best stuff, things that we value the most, and we are going to offer them up to you. And we know you're some kind of sort of formless God. We're not, you know, not sure what kind of form you have and how you take it, but we offer these burnt offerings to you, that you get the essence of it. You get to, somehow you're able to ingest it by us burning it, sacrificing it for you, that kind of thing. So we feel that we're appeasing the wrath of God by making these sacrifices. And sometimes it was human sacrifice also, actually, throughout history. That happened in the Aztecs. It was very, very, very severely and prominently. If you look at history, you see that most of the sacrifice and rituals was to appease cosmological appeasement. The Aztecs were trying to appease the heavens. This is why they did it, because of this destroyer planet that has come through cosmological severe disturbances. They felt if we just give what is most valuable to the one who's controlling the planet, these planets, and what controlling the cosmos, they will say, you're kind of nice people. I like you. I kind of want the tribute to keep on happening. If I destroy you, I won't get any more tribute. So this is a very important issue in this whole situation, is that if there's two kingdoms and one kingdom comes in that destroys the other, they won't get any bounty from that kingdom for quite some time, right? Whereas if diplomatically you go to the king, the powerful king, and say, king, look, we'll give you this tribute every year. We'll give you this tribute in perpetuity. If you just leave us alone, we'll continue to generate this wealth, and you'll continue to get this massive amount of wealth flowing into your coffers. And the king said, wow, that's great. If I attack you, I won't get that. So we project this on God and say, you know, God, listen, we're going to keep this sacrifice going continuously, and we will continuously be dedicated. Everybody here in the world, let's dedicate ourselves to this sacrifice of giving you what is most precious, that you love the most. And if you don't attack us through sending this planet, we will continue to be thriving here in this world, and more riches, and we'll give more and more sacrifice to you, and you'll be happier and happier and happier. Happy king. Happy, happy king, happy life. Okay. And so the people really believed in this. They really bought into it. They said, this gives us hope. And it seemed to calm this dread that they have within. This gives us hope. They said, yeah, it works here in the world. Why can't it work with God? God's reasonable, like the neighboring king. They're reasonable enough to say, okay, we make this deal, made a deal. And God should be just as wise, we hope. We hope, right? That's what we're thinking. So the sacrifice is very, very important to keep it going perpetually, thinking that this is appeasing God and preventing the return of this destructive planet, Nibiru, Nemesis, Wormwood, turning all the waters red with its iron oxide, turning the everything, you know, just causing famine and plagues. It's horrible, horrible stuff. So we, the people of the world thought they had found a way, and that there was a special priest designated to do this that was specially pleasing to God, who knew what was pleasing to God. This is the idea that there's a certain people who God said, okay, I made a deal, but you've got to have people who know exactly what I really want, and those are this priestly caste, sacrificial priestly caste, who thought they knew what kind of sacrifices, what to give God, what to offer God, what did God like, what keeps God happy. Now, are you with me so far? Very interesting, isn't it? Now, we come up to a time in history. Let's take the time of Jesus, for instance, where we know that after the time of Jesus, that the Romans sacked Jerusalem and stopped the sacrifice in the temple, right? Initially, the Babylonians stopped it, and then they had the exile in Babylon, and they came back and rebuilt the second temple. But that too was the zealot revolt. That too was the sacrifice was stopped. Which was a very severe thing. The people were absolutely, it was the most severe thing possible. They took this with the utmost seriousness, because the notion is that we can stay on God's good side and we'll prevent this future disaster from happening in this world. But if we stop the sacrifice, God's going to get angry again and send this planet again. So this is very serious business. It is a catastrophe. It's like, oh, there's a catastrophe. God's, you know, no more sacrifice, no more happy God. It's like you got to keep feeding God the wine, the good wine, the good stuff, the best stuff. Now, we have a situation which we call the Christian religion. Well, what does it tell us? It tells us that God sent his favorite son, his only son. Now, this makes it super special. Like in history, if you have your only son, that only son carries your lineage. It's very important. So this is God's only son, which means it's the most precious thing to God possible. Sent this into the world. And we say, well, to stay here, to live with us. But then the story goes, well, what we did is we decided to offer up the Son of God, the only Son of God, the most precious thing to God possible. We offered that up as a sacrifice to God. And saying, God, you know what? We don't want to we want to show you how committed we are to staying on your good side and you looking favorably upon us. And we know that out of all the precious stuff in this world, the most precious is your son that came here to live with us. And so we are willing to offer up your son as a sacrifice to you. Okay, you get this? And in doing so, that this will not only greatly please you and endear us to you, but it is will so endear us to you that it'll endear us to you forever and forever and forever. you will say, ah, I will never again send any punishment upon these people here. They returned my son to me. They didn't keep my son. They gave my son back to me. You see, that's how it works. So this is why they offer up Jesus as a living sacrifice to God, to appease the wrath of God. We're saved by the blood of the Lamb. The Passover has to do with one of the passages of Nibiru here, and the terrible plagues and the fleeing from that plague and the going part of the Red Sea, you know, all this kind of stuff. Passover means that they sacrificed the blood of the Lamb, and they were not sacrificed. So the idea of being passed over from the vengeance of God is those who give this sacrifice to God. God will say, I will spare you my wrath. So the idea of having Jesus, the only Son of God, being sacrificed and given back to God, they feel those who believe in that accept this sacrifice, God will not have any wrath upon them. Now, there's another aspect to all this. There's another aspect of our psyche that needs to be looked at. This has always been a troublesome one for me. But throughout history, we've had this belief that we are what we eat. And also, that in eating something, we get rid of it, so to speak, and transform it into something that was dangerous to us. Now it is pleasing to us. You know, the wild animals, we get them, we cook them, we eat them. We take on their attributes. The psyche thinks that we take on the strength and the power and the courage and the ability to defend ourselves from these animals, from what we eat. It used to be cannibalism. Used to eat part of the warriors that they slain in battle. We think we take on their power and their courage, and their power and courage is completely nullified forever. If we eat it, it's been nullified forever. It's different than burying it somewhere. That the actual eating of something transforms it somehow, spiritually transforms it, so it's no longer a threat to us in any way. This is very important to understand this. The psychology of eating in ancient peoples is very powerful. Now, we have this ancient psychology in the mass of Christianity, of eating the blood and the flesh of Jesus Christ, so to speak. But it goes deeper than that. It goes deeper. There's a deeper meaning to all of this. When this planet, Nibiru, appears to us as the sun, somehow the sun manages to light it up a little bit. It looks like a disc in the sky, a disc, like a pale disc in the sky, or a pale reddish disc. It doesn't reflect light as much light as other planets, actually. It's not like Venus. Venus is very unusual as far as planets. We think planets are shining brightly. That's not necessarily true with all planets. It depends on the constitution of the planets. Mars is sort of a dull red. Different planets have a different, you know, albedo, the different reflectiveness. And apparently planet X doesn't have much reflectiveness until it gets really close to the sun. And a certain juxtaposition to the sun, then you can see it like as this round disk in the sky. Now, we know that we think that we can get rid of God by gradually dying, having many, many, many separate bodies, all the separation of things, that they all die. And we think that in this way we're gradually killing God, killing reality, so there's no attraction to awakening from this dream. There's no attraction to awake from the cosmological dream if God is dead. So all this impermanence is really our plan to get rid of God. Okay? So we have this very powerfully in us, this notion that if you, there's a way to get rid of something very powerful bit by bit by bit by bit by bit. This is our whole scheme to try and disempower awakening by getting rid of the attraction of reality, which is God, isn't it? So our mind goes along those lines, and it says, hey, there's this planet, there's this terrible cosmological body comes by and just wreaks awful destruction and catastrophe upon us. We want to get rid of it. So, sure, we're appeasing, we have this thing going with God of sacrifice. We said, but let's double down on it. Let's double down on it. Let's make, you know, doubly sure. And so the other plan that they used. They combined, they sort of like two defensive strategies. They combined the two of them. One, sacrificing Jesus to please God. The second one, and it gets a little confusing theologically here, but the second one is the Eucharist. Okay, the Eucharist. And what I'm saying is the Eucharist is this round disc. Okay, this round disc as it is actually a symbolic representation, a psychic representation of this planet Nibiru. And by continuously having all these Catholics, Christians go to Mass and eat this, you know, they wanted to go every single day, but you know, some go once a week, some go every day. Everyone takes this Eucharist, okay, and they eat it and they consume it, and it, you know, is completely dissolved within their bodies. They believe that in this way we're gradually destroying this planet bit by bit by bit by bit by bit. Okay, it's a symbolic, sympathetic magic, you know, thing, but in our logic, it's very powerful. We have a powerful belief in it because we're trying to actually destroy God by our bodies being born here. We're trying to destroy God bit by bit by bit, and we think it's working. Otherwise, we'd freak out. Oh, it's not working. Oh my gosh, you know, panic. So we believe in this sort of magic, magical belief it's called. The whole existence is built on magical belief that we can get rid of God, and therefore the attraction to awakening, we can get rid of it. And so we can finally live here in peace and not be attracted to awakening from the dream. This is the problem. So we powerfully believe that bit by bit by bit by bit, we can destroy what is powerful. And so we've set up this global system, which is now, we call it Catholicism, where you go in and you get this wafer and you eat it and it dissolves within you. And you're being told that this is your salvation. This is your salvation. This is how you're saved. What they're really getting at is this planet is going to be saved, they think, because by taking the Eucharist, you're destroying this disc in the sky bit by bit by bit by bit by bit. They make a symbolic representation of the disc, Nibiru, how it appears in the sky, and then break it up into many, many trillions of fragments, little wafers, and throughout the thousands of years, people have been ingesting, you know, I don't know how many trillions of wafers have been ingested, and they believe it's actually bit by bit by bit disintegrating this planet, and there'll be no more. Ultimately, it won't exist anymore. Like an animal, you eat it all, gone. It can never resurrect. It can never resurrect. So all of this stuff is sort of wrapped up in Christianity, actually. The resurrection's also wrapped up into it in Jesus showing that the planet will return. Now, the idea, there's a couple things wrapped up in this. Jesus is the only Son of God. One, that's neat, we need to believe that in order for the preciousness to God, that covenant of an eternal satisfaction. God looks upon us favorably forevermore because we return what is most precious. If God had many, many sons, God would say, well, yeah, it's nice, but, you know, it's no big deal. So we say it's the only one. The other factor in all of Christianity is I found out that when you, those who are very much into sacrificial Christianity, if you ever mention anything that maybe Jesus isn't the only Son of God, they freak out and they want to kill you. Seriously. I've had this happen to me. I had it happen when I was young. I talked about Buddha. I said, well, Buddha has a lot of wisdom too. And they tried to kill me. I said, wow, what in the world's going on in their minds? Well, here is what's going on in their minds. When they say Jesus is the only Son of God, they say God is the creator of cosmology, all right? The heavens, the universe, all this. And we live in this star system with a sun. What they're saying is, there's only one sun in this solar system. This is not a binary system. It's just one sun. They think if they just believe that, it'll be true. And therefore, there is no binary orbit around a brown dwarf that could be happening. And the sun couldn't possibly, you know, pull this type of periodicity of 3,600 years. It couldn't possibly happen. It was like a one-time event, like something, some rogue, you know, comet going through or something, never to return. If it was just one sun, that's what you would have. But if there was a brown dwarf, it's a binary star system, then you could have this elliptical orbit around both, right? And it would return. So their focus is on, there's only one sun in this solar system. So Jesus is heavily associated with the sun. The ancients were worshippers of the sun. And they said, "Are you the Son of God?" Meaning, really, are you representing this, the sun and the sky? They were heavily into sun worship. It's understandable. It's understandable because the sun provides the light here. You're the light of God, the light of this, light of the sun. Are you the only Son of God? And they're very, it's very important for them to believe there's only one Son of God, not two. But they're talking about the star. And they're trying to, in their minds, trying to block out any notion that this could be a binary system. They're very resistant to that. Because they want to live in peace. They say, wow, we don't ever want this catastrophe, this planet to come back. So if it's just one star, it won't come back. If it's two, it's coming back. So this is the vehemence of the Christians. The Christians are using Christianity as a defense against realizing this, Nibiru is going to return. They feel that this is preventing its return, giving them a happy life, and if they just believe in this, they will have this beautiful millennial planet where nothing, no more fear, no more catastrophe, everything's beautiful and nice for them. So this is the cosmological way in which Christianity has been used. Now this is not Jesus' message to us, actually. It's quite different. Jesus says, indeed, that your dream is one of catastrophe and conflict. Inherently so. There's nothing that can be done about that. You have to awaken from the cosmological dream and realize you're the dreamer of it. It's not outside your mind. It's been inside your mind the whole time. And therefore, there's nothing outside of your mind. So you can't be outside of your mind either. So you cannot be in an abyss. The mind is a perfectly creative, all-causative power of God. So it's impossible to be separate from it. You cannot be outside in some abyss. So Jesus' teaching is very different than the religion of Christianity. The religion of Christianity is really a way to try and find peace of mind by denying that this is a binary star system we live in, solar system, binary system. By trying to appease God through the sacrifice, what they call of Jesus, that God will never send this destroyer through our system again because we've appeased God permanently. And by three, trying to destroy this planet by the Eucharist, by taking the Eucharist bit by bit by bit by bit, destroying this planet. So this is a very new exposition of Christianity. I've never heard anything like this before, which is why it was sort of hard to come up with. It just sort of popped into my mind like, oh, yeah. Whereas before, I hadn't seen this. I knew there was something. I just couldn't quite put it all together because it's very difficult to understand the delusional mind of absurdity. It's the logic that it follows without getting pulled into it such that you're so terrified that you don't want to see it. So you have to be able to see how the logic works without being pulled into it. It's very difficult. But I've been able to do that now. And so I'm able to be calm about all this and at the same time trace how their logic works and see that how their logic has given rise to this belief system, a ritual sacrificial belief system. And of course, what they also do in the Mass is they commemorate the sacrifice of Jesus to God, affirming that they haven't backtracked on this. This is also part of the whole ceremony they do, is we affirm that the sacrifice of Jesus, God, as a living sacrifice to you. I mean, in the Mass, the priest says these very things, living sacrifice to you, that by the blood of Jesus, we are spared punishment for our sins, we were saved and all this. So they reaffirm, yeah, we're not backtracking. Jesus is yours forever, and we know this. Jesus will keep you, your only son, having your only son with you and not here in this world, will keep you happy forever. And it's a conglomeration of defensive tactics and attempting to get rid of this terrible nemesis that historically has tormented the world so many times. So if you look at it like that, everything clicks into place and you say, oh, wow. And then you can understand why Jesus' teachings are actually quite different than the religion. The religion is a defensive attempt to get rid of this threat that we have here. But not by waking up from the dream, but trying to influence the dream. as if a stick figure in a dream could influence the dreamer. You know, it's trying to influence the dreamer, thinking it's separate from us. It's you could see it this way and say, oh, that all makes sense now. This makes logical sense, logic based on absurdity and arrogance and absurdity and the desire to separate from God. It all follows logically from that. But it has nothing to do with the teachings of Jesus, actually. Which is why when Jesus has come back now and has given teachings out, the Christians say, what the heck is that? That's not what we've been saying. Well, Jesus says, look, just sidestep the whole thing by dreaming a different dream, for one thing, a happy dream. A dream of returning home, a dream of awakening. Dream of awakening, Jesus says. And these things then will not happen. You will go to an intermediate, a reduced intensity zone, which is really another dream, a dream of awakening. And there's no catastrophes there at all. Because we're not projecting conflict and fear and separation and all the effects of that kind of dream, the way it happens. We're not doing that. So the dream of fear is full of cosmological catastrophes. Scientists are finding this out. We say, wow. See, the Christian religion is trying to teach that we can have this happy, millennial, beautiful kingdom here, the kingdom of God on earth, with no catastrophe, everything, if we just follow these rituals. Now, very interesting enough, most of the scientists, modern science, all of them, basically, in Western Europe, for instance, most science, a lot of it has come out of that, and China has it too, but most of it's come out of the Christian tradition, a lot of it. Some out of Islam as well, which is similar to Christianity. They're sort of brother, sister, you know, similar religions, Abrahamic religions. And their whole thing is that we live in now a time of peace, that the wrath of God has been appeased, and we don't need to worry about it anymore. So we can focus in on material wealth and happiness. So out of that belief system came all these focus on materialism, which we call these scientists. But they're really materialists. And the scientists have this long tradition now of saying, look, there's this steady cosmology is set, it's steady, it's calm, it's peaceful, no worries. This is their mindset. So any notion that there's some cosmological catastrophe, they go, oh, no. That's just, you know, that's nut. Those are wing nut jobs saying stuff like that. Baloney. Nonsense. We got to focus in on better materialism, more comforts here. We have peace in the cosmos. Well, there's another branch of scientists who are finding out that the cosmology is very, very chaotic and catastrophes and all this nasty stuff is happening, actually. All over. And that, you know, and so the tradition of Christianity, which supposedly has established the kingdom of God here in this world, no more wrath, and all the science that came out of that, they're now being challenged by those who are really taking a harder look at the whole thing. And they don't like it at all. Because everybody wants a nice, peaceful life, right? Come on. And so we don't want drastic catastrophe, so they're not happy at all about those who are saying, wait a minute, you know, not so fast. You're saying that there's no trouble? Oh, there's lots of trouble. Look at the record of the ancient history, if you look at it. I mean, we were so hoodwinked by these Christian scientists, well, that's not the right term, these scientists who came out of the tradition of Christianity, which is the belief that the wrath of God has been permanently appeased, so we can focus now on just making happy life, nice homes, happy life, that they whitewashed ancient history and what really happened. They gave a wrong picture of history, very false picture. The liars, deceivers, but wishful thinkers, you might call them. Severe wishful thinkers. And because they said, no, everything's steady, they couldn't admit that there ever was any problem. They said, no, it's always been just steady, smooth, evolution, whatever you want to call it. And there's never been any. But if you go back and really look carefully, as true scientists have done, all the great thanks to true scientists, they have discovered a massive catastrophic history of this planet. And it's like, uh-oh. You know, that brings up the old fears that the scientists that came out of Christianity, they don't want that. They want to live just a nice, comfortable life. Nice, bourgeois, comfortable life. You go to church once a week, keep affirming the sacrifice of Jesus, keep God's wrath away, take the Eucharist if you're a Catholic, and some I guess some Anglican, some still take some Eucharist in other tradition, you know, Christian traditions, and that, you know, is keep undermining any power out there that could bother us, you know, and we're destroying them and munching them away and eating them up, consuming them, consuming what we consume, we think is gone, destroyed. So they keep doing that and say everything's fine. We don't need to worry about anything. God's in control, no troubles. So let's focus on our nice bourgeois life, and that's it. And so anyone who brought up the truth about the history of this planet, they said, you're crazy. Well, they turn out to be the ones that were crazy. Okay, so things have flipped. The script has flipped on this. And this is helping out flip the whole script. And they have caused so much trouble to me and to many. By just putting us under this total extreme pressure that we're crazy, we're the ones who are wrong, you know, we're, you know, not true. They refuse to look at any evidence. They say, well, there's no evidence for us to look at, you know, so why should we even look at it? They ignore the evidence. They don't dig into it. They don't look at it. They just have all these defensive systems. Some scientists are some of the most defensive people there are. They're the most closed-minded people, amazingly closed-minded. Because, again, I've seen now how the roots, the purpose of Christianity, the whole purpose, the belief of, is that we have cut a deal with God, and God, no more destroy your planet coming through. So it's a moot, it's finished, so why even think about it? So then, to even feel more comfortable, we just ignore all evidence that I was ever there in the first place. This is where this, a lot of the science came from, actually, this perspective, this deep, rooted perspective. Which is, you know, absurd, completely absurd. So they're the ones who turn out to be the absurdists, as I've known all along. And the ones who are more honest and say, well, wait a minute here. I don't think that you can, you know, that cut a deal like that. I don't think that it works that way. They're the ones who turn out to be the realists and the pragmatists. That doesn't mean that there's nothing we can do. In fact, there's way more that we can really do than we realize, but certainly not through using sympathetic magic. We can change our minds about our purpose for this dream, actually. We have to own the dream, of course. This is called superpositivity, is owning the dream. Instead of saying, no. God's causing the dream, all this, and we just have to try to be real positive towards God so God will give us a happy dream and won't punish us for our sins. We need to make our behavior better so we're not punished. That's not owning the dream at all. That's duality. That's actually making the dream even more obscure to us, even more obscure. And that's what, you know, you end up building bunkers underground, hiding underground, instead of ascending into a reduced intensity zone. So big difference, you know, if you own the dream, you realize it's all within your own mind. All of this is just within our mind, own mind, actually. Each one of us, this is just in our own mind. We each have this sort of universe in our own mind. Well, there's just one mind, actually. There's just one mind. It's not like my own mind. There's just one mind. But we all are ideas in the mind of God. Okay? We're all ideas in the mind of God. If you own it, the dream, very different destiny path, right? Very distant. You're not like trying to hide underground at this point. You're saying, I'm not troubled. You know, I feel that if you own the dream, then don't you have power over the dream? If you can't try to give the power away and don't own the dream and say, well, no, God's the one's dreaming this and not me, then this isn't true. And so you feel that you don't have power over your life or the dream or anything, and you have to try to get on the good side of the one that does, and yes, bad stuff keeps happening and you can't figure it out. So you have to keep doing more rituals, trying to figure out, how do I appease this the dream, God, you know, how do I appease God? And it's just a never-ending cycle of torment and hope and fear and all this kind of stuff. It's terrible, terrible. So what Jesus tells us is own the dream and realize waking up from it is not a death sentence, is not an annihilation at all. So you can see the wishful, hopeful thinking of Christianity throughout the millennia. In the central tenet of Christianity, it says you have to have faith. The mystery of faith, you know, the Eucharist, the mystery of faith, they say this, is, they claim how it is we're destroying this planet is a mystery of faith. Well, sympathetic magic is what it is. It doesn't work. Of course, it has to be a mystery of faith. And the reason why they call it a mystery of faith is because we won't know if it works or not until Nibiru comes back, right? Or doesn't, right? So it's gone for 3,600 years, and so you're doing this eating of the Eucharist, and you believe, well, this is going to work, this is going to work, this is going to work. Well, is it the mystery of faith? We don't know for sure that it's working. We just have to believe that it's working. And ultimately, we'll find out, you know, of course they say mystery of faith. So it all fits now. And of course, some people don't want to hear this because they say, no, 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 I need this to prevent this planet, you know, prevent catastrophe. There's a lot better way. It's just don't be here when it happens, for one thing, right? That's a nice prevention. I mean, why do people keep thinking, you know, this is the only place that they're stuck here on this planet? There could just be a wormhole open up, and you find yourself somewhere else, just like that. Lots of things that we're becoming aware of now. We're not stuck here at all. But those who have bought into this mystery of faith thing feel that this planet is going to be theirs, to be a perfect paradise, and they want to stay here, and they believe that all the efforts they've made were successful efforts, and there isn't going to be any problems here in this world. And so they don't see any reason to leave the world. And Christianity is kind of divided on that. There are those who believe the tribulation will come, which are more the Protestants. And the Catholics say, no, it's already happened back in Roman times, the destruction of Jerusalem, whatever. And now we're just the millennium. We're waiting for Jesus to return and set up this millennium perfect paradise here in this world. So they're not likely to, you know, leave the planet, rapture. The Protestants more feel that the tribulation is coming, and they may need to be raptured off the planet to avoid it. And they kind of stopped believing in this, some of this stuff, although they still, you know, believe in the sacrifice of Jesus, but the Eucharist thing is a lot, they believe in that, I think, less, a lot less. various things they believe in less. Okay, so we've covered that. It's a big meal, right? Like, wow, this is a complete game changer, isn't it? Complete flipping, massive flipping of the script here. Yes, it is. Another one, the goddess. I talk about the goddess and difference between God and the goddess. It's very simple, actually. God represents what I call superpositivity, which means this is just all a dream. Just wake up from the dream, everything's fine. Perfect. You're still perfect. I use analogy of this river, a huge rock in the river that the river can't move at all. The river has to go around the rock. And imagine if this rock dreams that it's a swimmer in the river, and this swimmer is trying to swim upstream to safety to the rock because the river keeps pushing it downstream, and it's desperately swimming towards this rock. And yet, even though it's swimming vigorously overall, the current is still sweeping the swimmer downstream, even though the swimmer is trying to facing upstream, right? I mean, you can get in an airplane, you can walk down towards the back of the airplane, and you're saying, well, I'm going back towards where we came from. Well, yeah, you might be going 5 miles an hour, but you're going, you know, 450 miles an hour towards your destination. So you're still going 445 miles an hour towards your destination. And of course, when you reach the end of the plane, you have to stop, and then you're going, you know, full speed. So you're still going far away from where you left. So the swimmer is trying to swim back to the rock, thinking that safety, security, happiness, and they think, yeah, I'm really making progress, but they're being swept away downstream. But now imagine that you're a rock, that you realize, no, I'm not a swimmer, I'm a rock, I'm just dreaming I'm the swimmer. I was never, as a matter of fact, there's not even a river at all. Okay, let's take it one step further. Not only is there no swimmer swimming in a stream to come back to the rock, I'm the rock, I never left what I am, I can never leave what I am, there's not even any river to sweep anything away in the first place. Everything is just peace. Everything is just calm. This is called awakening from the dream. So this is what Jesus tells us. This is what God tells us. Just awaken from the dream. That's the solution. So this is called superpositivity, where we just assert there is no dream. There is no, I'm already awake. None of the dream was real. None of it even existed. No river, no swimmer. No river, no swimmer. No teacher, no teaching, no student, so to speak. Right? It's very important. The teacher would be the one teaching the swimmer how to swim faster. something like that. The teaching might be the overall dynamic, that there's a teacher teaching this, how to swim upstream, and then the student is the one trying to swim faster, and the trouble would be the river. But when you wake up from the dream, you realize there is no swimmer, there is no river, so there's no need to be a teacher of how to swim upstream better in the river. No teacher, no teaching, no student. This is called superpositivity. This is what we emphasize and stress here, is superpositivity. This is God-based teachings. Now, the other teaching is entirely different. It's called positivity training, how to be positive here. And this comes out of the Christian belief and the belief of the hope of everyone in the world, really, is that we can have a happy life in this world. And we just have to learn how to emphasize the positive stuff, the good stuff, how to work together in harmony to build better buildings, produce and distribute better food, all this stuff. It's called the goddess religions. This is appealing to the goddess. Because when we're helpless and desperately desiring comfort, what are we? We're babies. And who do we turn to? The mother. So we have this archetypal symbol of the mother, the goddess, the bountiful goddess who provides us with positivity. And that's the other belief system, is that we need to go towards, we focus on positivity in the world. This is entirely different than super positivity. Super positivity says this world doesn't even exist at all. It's just a dream. And whereas positivity says, yes, this world is real, it does exist, and our goal should be to emphasize the positive here, the good stuff. Dwell on the good things, the positive, have good harvest, do better, better trees, better agriculture, better production, better distribution, feed the poor, let's have everyone have a car, clean energy, on and on and on and on and on. This is the goddess religion, it's called. And so what Christianity has done is initially it started out as trying to be God-centered superpositivity of Jesus. Jesus brought in this superpositivity. But gradually that began to be chipped away at, and the big chipping away was keeping the Madonna and Child symbology of Isis, Osiris-Isis religion of Egypt, which was mother goddess worshiping, a positivity teaching. Keeping that, the icons throughout the Roman Empire, all the rest were destroyed when Constantine decided to use Christianity as the official religion of the Roman Empire. The aristocratic women throughout the empire were heavily, heavily into Isis worship, goddess worship, materiality, comforts, positivity, very much into positivity. How can I have a good children, happy life, good clothes, good food, good dwelling, good husband, good relatives, good experiencing, positive stuff, heavily, heavily into that. And so they said, no, you got to let that stay. And so it stayed throughout the Roman Empire, all over. The Madonna and Child icon was present everywhere. So that became incorporated into Christianity. It was not part of Christianity at all. It was not part of it. But it was super prevalent all over the whole area. So you see that was, people were still into that. So it was not like it didn't exist before. It existed, of course. Ancient Egyptian religion existed before Christianity. But it was not part of the official canon, of worshiping the Virgin Mary. No, absolutely not. Absolutely was not there. But now in the 19th, 20th century, the Roman pontiff has made all sorts of declarations that the goddess is co-redeemer with Jesus. Co-redeemer. In other words, putting positivity, the teachings, the belief system of positivity, on the same level as the teachings and belief system of superpositivity, and saying that they together, both of them working together, is what the answer is. There could not be a more false teaching than this. This is the heart of what Jesus says. You must not fall for this trap. Somehow that you can integrate truth and lies. This is absurdity at its very most dangerous, is the belief of integrating truth and lies. And that there's some third category. See, this is absurdity's greatest hope, is there's some third category, which is neither reality nor the denial of reality. And it's some permanent third category. Not just like there's a happy dream of awakening. That's not a permanent third category. It's a happy dream awakening, which is set down and there's no more once we realize there's no river, no swimmer, everything's perfect. That is not any such thing as a third permanent category. What absurdity is trying to find is some fusion of truth and lies to present a third separate category where we can still be prime creators of a separate creation and yet it be a peaceful creation. And it says that by making the goddess teachings of positivity on the same level as the God teachings of superpositivity, that we can get this fusion taking place and we'll have this new creation where it's all peaceful and everything's perfect and wonderful. This is completely insane. Absurdity at its very worst. But we're super tempted in that direction. So Catholicism has gone in that direction to extreme extent now, an extreme extent where the Virgin Mary, which is really, you know, goddess, Isis, whatever you want to call it, it's goddess worship. It's positivity worship is what it is. That's been put on the same level as worshiping Jesus, the bringer of truth to this world. And Protestants, of course, reject this. They say, no, that's a huge mistake. And it is indeed a huge mistake. They say Jesus is the only way. What they're trying to get at, it's a bit of a mishmash. What they're trying to get at is super positivity is the only way. Not both positivity and super positivity integrated. Because super positivity completely denies any need for positivity altogether. You don't need the swimmer swimming faster upstream. Like, you don't need a coach saying, come on, you can do it, go faster, you know, you're making progress, kick harder, oh yeah, you're doing great. Because there is no swimmer, and there is no river. They don't exist. They're nothing but figments, wishful thinking, figments of our own imagination, wishful thinking, whimsical absurdity. So it's crazy to try and emphasize both. You're only going to get severe confusion out of this, or lethargy. You know, you'll get lethargy or severe confusion. If you're really a go-getter, you'll get severe confusion and depression. If you're not, you'll just kind of get this zombie-like lethargy, just like, you know, your mind just seems to have no depth to it at all anymore. That's what happens. It shallows you out. You have to be shallowed out, otherwise you'd see this is ridiculous. So positivity and superpositivity are apples and oranges. They aren't, even though there may be superficial similarities, you could always draw superficial similarities if you try hard enough. You get people going in two different directions. You say, well, they're both walking, they're both breathing, they're both making progress, or, you know. Yeah, but they're going in completely different directions. You know, these are called superficial similarities, which, you know, it's absurd then to draw a conclusion that they're both the same or similar. They're not similar. Superpositivity and positivity are diametrically opposite, actually. I mean, one denies the other. Superpositivity says there's no need for positivity. Superpositivity covers it all. Reality's perfect. Okay? And positivity denies superpositivity. You say, no. There are negativities, there are troubles, there are problems, but we can work on those, we can fix those, we can make it better. That denies the present reality, present perfection right here, right now. Absolutely denies it. Although they make it very confusing. They try to fudge in every way. But it's still fudging in every way. It's very easy to see through if you really want to. So you have this vast rising out of the attempt to Christians to get rid of Nibiru, the belief that we can have our cake and eat it too, that now we can have this happy world where no more catastrophe, no more troubles severely, and we can work on solving the problems of humanity and everything's going to be wonderful. And this is what's called positivity belief, and naturally the goddess is the motif used for that. And has been and is being used. United Nations uses the goddess as its divinity because its aim, all the sustainable development goals, its aim is positivity, to make this world a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful place that would just like a heavenly place. Everyone's just so happy here, right? That's their goal. And so this is how it is in this dream. Now, I'm sure the real Virgin Mary, the Mary, is appalled by this goddess worship because she's most likely a super positive. I would say it's very, very likely she was a super positivist, as the apostles were. So she would absolutely reject this goddess-worshipping notion. Totally, 100% reject this. This is absolute nonsense. It's also the idea, as you're a child, a defenseless, helpless child, the mother is the big supreme protector, right? So as this religion of Christianity has been wrapped around protecting ourselves from Nibiru, the motif of let's bring the mother in also, and she can help out, you know, protect the child. If we worship her too and venerate her too, she will, like a magnetic sphere, we realize that our magnetosphere is severely messed up by the greater magnetic field of Nibiru. And so the mother is like this atmosphere. You often see the Virgin Mary in blue robes like the sky. It sort of represents the atmosphere, and we're worshiping the atmosphere and saying that the atmosphere is peaceful. So the Virgin Mary is this very placid, peaceful presence. It's really a way of symbolizing the atmosphere, okay? Along with this positivity motif, it's also, these symbols have multiple meanings and to the magical minded. It symbolizes a placid, beautiful, calm atmosphere, and that if we just worship this atmosphere, we think that it will stay in place, and that we think sometimes it gets angry at us and decides to go crazy, and that we don't quite understand why. So we think by worshiping this atmosphere in the form of a mother, that it will act motherly toward a child and be peaceful and calm and gentle. Okay, so it's all wrapped up in cosmology, in atmosphere, in the planet, in nature, all this stuff trying to control the universe, trying to control a dream without realizing or accepting that it is just a dream. And that the dream goes all at once. You don't have part of it real and part of it not real. That's impossible. Either something is real or it's not. Either it's real or it's not. You can't have half of truth true and the other half not true. Then the original truth never existed at all. You see, you can't have oneness and then say, yeah, and then, but part of oneness isn't one, it's separate. And then, that's absurdity. If that's the case, there never was a truly existent oneness in the first place. It's meaningless to even talk about it. So you can't have your cake and eat it too. You can't have God and then have these absurdist teachings and still have God. It doesn't work that way. Either God is or God isn't. And the answer is God is. So the absurdist teachings are simply absurdist teachings. Now, I had this very unusual experience yesterday where my neck seized up on me. And it was terrible. And I tilted my head back, and it suddenly seized up and spasmed on me and gave me this incredible pain, and I couldn't move my head. My head was frozen. I couldn't move it at all, and just devastating pain. My eyes were closed. I just like, you know, just, oh. And I did this over and over and over. I was really in misery, but I was calm. I said, okay, this is just, I'm being shown what's going to happen to this planet by the passage of Nibiru. It's like suddenly your neck locks in place. You know how like everything seems fine, suddenly you wake up and like the neck is tight, and suddenly your neck goes out and it freezes up on you, and like you can't move your head. Your head's like a planet, and suddenly like you don't realize how important the neck muscles are until they freeze up on you. I couldn't even lean back to go to bed if the pain was so severe. I can't even do it now. I can't even lean back. So you know, it was bad during the daytime, but it didn't lock up on me like it did there at night. So we're seeing all these planet changes. And what's going on? We know the planet's under stress. We don't know exactly why. We keep thinking, no, we're the ones. Humans are doing it. But at some point, it could suddenly lock up on us. And that's what the elites are worried about. They have access. The elites have access to all the best instrumentation, all the best scientific data, all of this, as well as remote viewers and psychics and all of this stuff. They pay them well. So they realize that the convergence of all this stuff at some point could most definitely cause like a lockup situation, like the neck locking up on you, and the head suddenly, you know, being, you know, frozen in place. And so they're expecting troubles to suddenly, Jesus said the troubles will come upon us like a thief in the night, suddenly. So there could be some really sudden problems arise in this world that, just like for me, I was just going along, everything's fine, and suddenly my head is locked in place, like looking up like this. I couldn't move my body. Terrible pain, and it was frightening. I've never experienced anything like that. Oh, man. And I couldn't work today. I can't drive. Obviously, if you turn like this and suddenly your head locks up, you can't drive. So I couldn't go to work today, which is why I'm doing this video. It's very bad. I need to work. I haven't missed a day of work in like 14 years, I don't think. So this is very significant. And I started studying Planet X more. I had some time to do that. And found some very credible evidence. There's some people are more credible than others. You just see their background. There's some people who are really connected with the establishment, who are whistleblowers. And you realize what they're saying is largely credible. They don't have all of the answers. But I've come across several credible people recently who the big picture is starting to emerge, and they have connections with the elites, and they know what's going on. They really do. Not entirely. And they tend to be much more mellow and calm, relaxed, and less on a witch hunt than other people do. You notice this characteristic in them. They just kind of say very factual, say, okay, this is, you know, this is what's going on. And whereas the ones that are like, you know, all gloom and doom and anger and hostility and all this kind of stuff, and they're very confused in their minds. They have some pieces, but they can't quite put it all together, especially what to do about it. You know, I've always focused on what do we do about this? Let's take refuge in the court of the Dharma King, which means take the context of truth as our companion, right? And Dharma means spiritual protection, really. It's how we protect our minds from falsity. So let's protect our minds from falsity. And the Dharma King represents those who historically have awakened from the dream and have no possibility of falling under the spell of this dream anymore at all. They're so comfortable being awake. They're able to offer tremendous spiritual protection, which means they're able to offer a context of super positivity to us. So the real solution to Nibiru is to accept a context of super positivity and don't no longer seek refuge in positivity. Okay, that's a huge mistake to try to combine the two. Now, pragmatically, in this world, you don't want to reject. You don't have to reject positivity, actually reject it. You just say, I don't really need it. I have super positivity. And as you go about here, people say, well, you're worrying, you got a house, you got clothes. Is it, well, yeah, we don't want to suffer, okay? But we're not buying into the whole belief system at all. We're not buying into it at all. We're buying into super positivity. And super positivity, of course, doesn't tell you that this is the only place, dwelling place, and that you're stuck here. And you have to make this world wonderful. No, it doesn't say that. It leaves it open. It's open. You know, we could dream a dream of awakening. Now, Jesus doesn't get into this in the Course in Miracles. He doesn't talk about Nibiru or anything at all. That would interfere with what he was trying to get, the momentum he was trying to build up. But that doesn't mean he doesn't know about it. You see, when you want to... if you know what the solution is, which is super positivity, it really is, then what you want to do is build up momentum in that direction. That's all important. So Jesus knows how to build momentum. The Dharma Kings know how to build up momentum towards the solution. They're not fear-mongering. I mean, because that is then causes you to get too... lose your clarity and start going into positivity and, oh, I'm more doomed, but maybe I can get some underground bunker and whatever, take refuge in the mother, I hope the sky stays nice, you know, all this stuff. You lose momentum towards super positivity, and then for you're not prepared when the problem comes. So just because Jesus didn't say anything in A Course in Miracles, Journey Beyond Words, the other voice, those books, his transmissions, more recent transmissions, doesn't mean Nibiru's not coming. It means he wants us to focus on super positivity. So when it does come, you'll be ready. And in the Bible, he's again and again, he says, look, there's this terrible catastrophe coming. You better be prepared ahead of time. Okay, so don't focus on the, you don't know when it's coming. In other words, don't focus on the catastrophe. Well, that's a 36,000 year orbit, 3600, I'm sorry, orbit. You know, don't worry about exactly when it's coming. Just prepare with super positivity. This is what Jesus, his message, just prepare. So the ones who are helping out the most here are just telling you, just prepare through super positivity. And when it gets here, it'll get here. And you'll be ready. And you'll say, well, I don't need this scenario. I don't need to pray to the sky, pray to this, pray to this, pray to this. I can just decide that I'm not, for me, that's not going to be my dream. I'm going to dream a happy dream of awakening, of no troubles at all. And so we affirm this for everybody. May everyone have this. The only way for us to have anything is to desire it for all, because we're all one, actually. And we cannot desire something for ourselves without desiring it from everyone else. And if we try to say, I want it, but the other shouldn't have it, then we're believing in separation, which just attracts us to falsity and defending absurdity. And so we won't have a happy dream of awakening. So the way to have a happy dream of awakening is to desire all the best, all peace, you know, all protection, all happiness, all benevolence to everyone, that everyone awaken from the dream. And in offering it to everyone, you're offering it also to yourself, right? Because we're all one mind, all the children of God, actually. And there's no separation at all. So, but offering it to everyone, we're reaffirming there's no separation, which is very important. This is the happy dream awakening, affirming there's no separation, never has been. This is super positivity. We never fell from grace. We've never been in a world. We've never been troubled by anything. This is just a dream of bodies, okay? A dream of sacrifice, actually. This whole universe is sacrificial. So when we talk about positivity, we're not waking up to the fact of what the purpose of the dream is. We're just trying to get our little chunk of, you know, before we die, before we're sacrificed, I hope we could have a kind of a positive life, you know, play a few nice rounds of golf before we go. That's not awakening from the dream. That's not repenting at all. So the goddess thing is not a repentant religion at all. It's not a repentant teaching at all. It's a positivity. Super positivity is a repentance. A repentant mind goes for super positivity, which realizes, I made all this up. It's never really happened at all. It's just wishful projection of a wishful scenario. I call it a hypothetical scenario. We're just projecting this hypothetical scenario of what we think separation could be like if it ever was. But it never will be. So none of this has actually ever happened. As you hear the teacher say, nothing has ever happened. That is true. Nothing has ever happened. It was all just a dream of again, a hypothetical scenario of what if separation could happen, maybe it would be like this. It's like a house. You want a house. You go to sleep. You're dreaming of a house. Kind of house you might want. And in the dream, it seems to be real, and you wake up and realize the house is the same. Nothing has changed in your house. You never had that other house. It never existed. It's just a figment of our imagination. So all of this is taking place, bodies, worlds, is it just a figment of spiritual imagination? It's never actually happened at all. This is how projecting a dream works. I remember in a dream, I became aware when I woke up. I was dozing. I woke up. I projected like millions of years as if it was sequential. And I did it just in an instant. It was all in the moment. I just, in this one moment, I dreamt of a sequence of moments. But all that sequence of moments was just a momentary thing. But if you don't see this, you think you're lost in this sequence of moments of time. But you're not at all, actually. There never was any time there. There's never any time. Time doesn't exist. Again, it's a what if separation existed. We'd have these sequence of moments. But there aren't any sequence of moments. Each moment we're having, we're just dreaming of a sequence of moments. This is how it is. We're dreaming of process, sequence of moments, time, space, process, and form. Each moment we're again renewing this belief in time, space, process, and form. But it's all just a projection of our mind in the moment. that it actually doesn't exist other than in just this moment. And each moment is perfectly free, so that it doesn't have any continuity to it at all, which is what we... And the realization of this is our continuity fear. I say we have a terrible problem with continuity fear, is waking up and realizing, wait, none of that stuff had any continuity to it at all. There's no continuity from one moment to another except the moment and the awareness and the will. All that is perfect continuity. So you have like this perfect continuity of freedom. And it's a peaceful, gentle, peaceful continuity. It's like perfect continuity, actually. So we're thinking there's no continuity because there's no time, actually. But what we really experience is a perfect continuity of absolute freedom. So turning the corner on this issue is all important. And this can dawn on us at any moment, any moment. We can just say, oh, I get it. And the thing is that the perfect continuity is so perfect, we think that it isn't in continuity at all. We're like, what is this? What is this? Where's my time, space, process, form continuity? But it's really our perfect continuity of perfection and freedom and causality that it's present every moment. Therefore, we can have perfect continuity to anything we want. You see, this is what we realize is, as Jesus said, anything you want at all is yours, like the flick of a switch, for as long as you want it, for as often as you want it, forever and ever and ever. That's what perfect continuity, isn't it? So if we want something to last, it will last as long as we want it to last, and there's nothing that can stop that or interfere with it. And if we want to go on to some other experiencing, that will arise also. We can have that too. So perfect freedom is really perfect continuity. Seen properly. Whereas in this world, we don't have perfect continuity at all, right? What is it that we want to last? Everything here is impermanent and keeps changing. You know, we want the weather to be a certain way and it keeps changing. What we don't have perfect, we have terrible continuity here. We're like caught in non-continuity is really the thing. We're caught in non-continuity. We're caught up in this hideous play of impermanence, dream of impermanence. Where there seems to be traces of continuity, but that's just enough to tempt us into keep hoping, and then within that backdrop is just this all this churning and changing, and you know, one day I get up to try to turn the car on, the battery's dead. It's like, what? How's that possible? You know, hideous continuity break. I bump into somebody. Tap cars. Your neck freezes up. You're exhausted, you know, all this stuff. I say, I don't want this, you know, that's a very severe break with my nice, smooth flow I'm trying to have my life. And we can't ever keep it the way we want it. So we have this hideous lack of continuity. However, we're familiar with it. So the idea of awakening to perfect continuity is a shock of our expectations are shocked. And we say, ah, what is this? What is this? What is this? Well, it's perfect continuity. You want a world of beautiful flowers? You got a world of beautiful flowers. You want it the next moment to be also the same? It's the same. Next moment the same. Next moment the same. As long as you want it the same, it's the same. And the fact of this freedom always remains the same. That never changes. So our changing of experiencing never changes the fact that we're absolutely free, which means we're also free to never change it if we want to. So we have complete control of our experiencing, actually. This is how God created us, which is perfect continuity. So what we are is perfect continuity. And yet, be it ever so humble, there's no place like home, which was just drastic lack of continuity. And people try to get used to it, say, well, the one constant here is change, so we can get used to that. No, that's not, we're talking about continuity. The real continuity is we can either change or not change. That's real. That's how we were created. Not that we're forced into change. That's not. And then we don't know what the change is going to be like. That's not continuity. So as we are awakening here, we see this. Say, oh, wow. So you may see something like seem very negative, and then suddenly it seems like, oh no, it's perfectly positive. The negativity I saw was my expectations being shocked. So full stop in the wild practices believing that our expectations are going to be shocked, but that it's shocked because the positivity is so super. Okay, do you get that? This is our basic practice and premise here. This is the context of the court of the Dharma King. Is the practicing is that, yes, we're going to be greatly shocked. And yes, it's because, not from a lack of continuity, but actually because we see perfect continuity. Because the news is so good that it shocks our expectations, even though it's totally positive. This is the key to success on the spiritual path. It's called taking the goal as the path. This is the way Mahayana Buddhism defines itself, sort of as taking the goal as the path, Dzogchen too. The high teachings to say we take the goal as the path, meaning that the path is one of being shocked by great good news that's already present. We already have perfect continuity. What we are already is perfect. But that this shocks our expectations. We're so familiar with this belief in imperfection, lack of continuity, lack of freedom, that we're bound to time, space, process, and form, that when we see the truth, it shocks us very severely. So we take the truth as self-evident, and then we gradually glimpse it, keep glimpsing it, and get more and more used to it through the shock, managing the shocks and the success of seeing it. This is the path that really works. And they say, you take this path, you can be free in a lifetime, which I believe is true. The others just go on and on and on and on and on. They say, yeah, eons of lifetimes, eventually you'll get free. Talk about kicking the can down the road. What they say is, no, we have to generate a perfect self. The self isn't perfect, but gradually we can generate one. Now, that's duality, that's positivity, that doesn't work. Now, if you have right intent, you're going to awaken. Eventually, you're going to awaken in one way or the other, okay? So, you'll eventually get it. How are we doing? Let me see if I can peek into this. It's gone 148 and 177 gigabytes. That means this one could be a long video if I want it to be. Oh, wow. This neck has got a... It might have been too much exercise. This is very possible. I was doing so much exercise stretching these rubber bands that it probably, my shoulders probably like tightened up, and then that pulled the neck muscle out of place. This is what I'm thinking. Because I don't understand how it suddenly went out. I didn't do anything, but I think it has to do with all of this, the strain I've been putting myself. You can over-exercise and suddenly get it, you know, it suddenly spasms and tightens up. And that's, you know, probably what happened to me. Almost assuredly. The whole solar system is changing. Everything's changing. In a lot of very strong ways. See? Constantly. Seemingly inexorable change that we can't do anything about, and yet we try to, through magic, try to influence the cosmos. Trying to influence the cosmos through magic is the heart of most world religions, most historical belief systems, religions, rituals, all that stuff, believing that we could influence the cosmos through various rituals, etc., like that. And ultimately influence the sun, influence the moon, influence, you know, the planets, and influence ultimately Nibiru. And we could smooth it all out. We could get it to all work the way we want it to work. This is what's called, you know, the black tantra, or the techniques that trying to figure out a way to energetically control our environment, control everything. This is the goddess religions. Those who worship the goddess, pray to the goddess, they're looking for some way to control the cosmos and make it a happy place. Whereas the true tantra, the true practices of like Vajrayana Buddhism, etc., they're designed to wake up from the dream and dream a happy dream of awakening and realize that none of this actually ever happened. It was never, there's no extension in time ever took place. No extension in process ever took place. Time, space, process, and form are just these silly notions we have each moment in the moment, but they don't extend beyond the moment at all. They don't bind the next moment to the previous moment in any way. This is what Jesus tells us. This is what the great teachers tell us. The Dharma kings tell us. And the opponent to this teaching is the ones who say, no, this is all real. This dream is real. Bodies are real. This is our identity. This is the goddess religions. The yoga girl, they're the ones who are really strong, in charge of the upper echelon, so to speak, of power structure of it now. Because they feel that being women, they have a good understanding of what it's like to be a mother, how to relationship to children, how to implement this religion in the world, goddess worship. It's very virulent. It's so virulent now. I have to stay away from all the media and everything. I turned on the TV first time in a long time. The Holy Spirit gave me permission. I asked, should I do that? Because the Warriors, Golden State Warriors, were about to set this all-time record for wins in a season, 73. One of the greatest sports accomplishments in history, actually. It's just astonishing that they were able to do this. I don't know how anyone can even wrap their mind around how difficult that is. To beat the Bulls record is just, how is that possible? It just seemed like one of those untouchable records, and they did it. So I tuned in the fourth quarter just a little bit, and it immediately went to a commercial. And the first thing that pops up in this commercial is this yoga girl. This demimonde yoga girl thing, and all sleek and arrogant and sassy, and trying to tell us, what our attitudes need to be. And I just was so revolting. First I muted it, and I said, forget it, and I just turned the TV off. So, boom, I said, that's it. That shows me what's really going on. And then after they won the game, someone had a TV on, and I said, how's that? I looked at the celebration, I wanted to check in, and immediately it was this yoga girl interviewing, I think, Steph Curry or someone, hogging the spotlight for herself, trying to say, okay, this is what we want your attitudes to be like, this is how our focus, And immediately I left the room, I said, no. So, they're just swarming. They're swarming like termites everywhere to bring in this goddess religion of positivity, which is really one way also of denying, Planet X, Nibiru, not Planet X, but Nibiru, that it's coming in, that everything's fine, everything's wonderful. Just, enjoy your life like a little child, like a mother pampering a child. People want to be like in a relationship. They want to believe their life is like they're like little children, and the mother is just pampering them because she loves the children. The children are nice to her. And so she just, gives them all the treats, gives them all the nice things. How a mother will pamper a little child, pamper the child. The child just thinking, wow, the mother's the greatest thing ever. If I feel this comfort, she soothes it. I cry. She gives me this wonderful food, and I want to go somewhere. She takes me there. Just she takes care of me so well. People, that's what they want. It's reaction formation to the troubles that are coming. So they're very vulnerable to the whole yoga girl thing. And the yoga girl's thinking that they're getting all this power out of it, but that won't last very long. So you don't want to go in that direction, that is for sure. Now there could be a dimensional shift. That's possible, a fourth dimensional shift, where then people are just totally into materiality. They all act like spoiled little children, juveniles, with an all-benevolent mother bureaucracy taking care of them. So timing, I don't know the timing. And this is something that has been very difficult to determine. People are just bouncing around. They don't know what to say. And Jesus tells us, look, it's very difficult to know the time when it returns. Very difficult. Something about the drag of the comet tail, various all sorts of interactions make it extremely complex to determine when it will show up, actually. The breaking force of magnetic gravitational influences as it comes in, and Oh, you know, it's just really, really. So the Holy Spirit has certainly said that this year, May, June, July, especially July, is severe trouble here in this world, major stuff. Now, is this Nibiru? I don't know. Don't know. Maybe, maybe not. But it may be a precursor. We may, the elites may start taking drastic action as they realize it's getting very close. They may do all sorts of stuff to start diminishing the threat they feel they're under. They don't want their places discovered. They don't want the population breaking down their doors. They want the activists to be in death camps or something, really. I had a dream a couple nights ago. It was difficult to decipher because it was so bad, I don't even want to decipher it. But it was assassination of a plot. Assassination plot was carried out. And it looked like there was three shooters. I'm not sure if they all shot the same person or it was number of people. And then there was this older white male, sort of like 70s, you know, 75, 80-ish. And they then shot him because he was pleading to be put out of his misery. He said, what's happened is just so terrible. I don't want to live anymore. Put me out of my misery. So there's something, what happened in the dream was there's this, these were professional assassins from the intelligence, some kind of intelligence community or something, on hire. They look like Caucasian men, dressed in normal, respectable attire, and you wouldn't suspect them. And suddenly, they carried out this assassination. Very professional. It was not like some loony person or something. No, these were like absolutely. It was all planned out, heavily structured, planned out, organized, and the symbology of it, the reason why I think it was a political candidate was because it happened by a library, a book deposit, where the books are deposited, right? I mean, not a, you know, where Oswald was in a book depository. Then there was a plaza, like, and then there was a grassy knoll area. In other words, the symbology represented the whole same scenario as JFK assassination. So it seemed to indicate that it has to do with some political figure is going to be assassinated. Some very important political, I don't know who it was. You know, but you can make your assumptions. I think it's on the right. Someone on the right, someone conservative. If not several of them. I mean, this was very bad. Three different shooters. Now, Kennedy was a couple shooters. Really, Grassy Knoll and Oswald was a patsy, actually, set up. So he would take the blame for it. This is what happened. They needed a patsy, otherwise the evidence would point to the grassy knoll and point out to who really did it. So Oswald was told that this is what he needed to do. And then, you know, actually, supposedly he did it all on his own, but they set him up. And before Ruby killed Oswald, Oswald said, look, I'm a patsy. I was just set up. This is what he said. And I believe him. I believe him. He was a patsy. He was set up. This is how they operate, right? They have a fall guy that everyone blames, so they walk, the real perpetrators walk scot-free and nobody suspects. I mean, these people are professionals. They know their business. I mean, this is a no-brainer, right? You're going to have a patsy. Of course. So everything points to Oswald's a patsy. They say, this guy's been in the Soviet Union. He's a sharpshooter. We'll set him up in this book depository like this, and we'll make it seem like he did it. But Oswald, the way he reacted was not the reaction of someone who did it. Not at all. So if you look at the psychology of it, it was like someone was like, what the heck's going on? You know, I mean, he's like shocked by the whole turn of events. And he didn't react like somebody who had actually done it. He really did not. Was he part of it? I don't know. He might have been part of it. Maybe not. Maybe he didn't even fire. Yeah, it was possible. There's so much cover-up around that. So the elites, when they want to get rid of someone, they have these professional teams who are, you know, very, very skillful and know how to cover their tracks. They've been doing it for millennia. You know, they cover their tracks very, very well. they have the patsies in place and stuff. And so there are like three shooters I saw. Maybe one of them was a fall guy, a patsy. Like one of them's like a crazy guy, you know. They like to blame it on some lone wolf crazy person or something. But I saw it was all carefully pre-planned in advance. Very top-level job. And, you know, who's the target? It doesn't matter much because whatever happens is going to happen. And super positivity isn't bothered by any of that. We already realize it's likely to, things are going to likely get real rough coming up here. That the elites now are very nervous. And they don't want anybody to interrupt their plans at a high level. At a high level. That enough to stir the people up. Okay. I mean, we can talk about it here, and that's not a concern to them, really. And we're protected. We're not out to get them. I'm not out to expose, you know, where are they hiding, all this stuff. No, I'm not. It's not a getcha witch hunt here. So you have to tread a thin line here. We have equal compassion to all. We wish all benevolence to all. But they don't want their plans being brought to light. So they don't want anybody that's going to rock their apple cart. And I'm sure they're stipulating to the various candidates, look, you know, this is, you know, what you can say and what you can't say. If you keep saying what we tell you you can't say, then you're history. They make it very, very plain, and certainly there are ways of doing that. They say, look, you know, you could give you some slack or give you some leeway, but there's certain things you can't say. And if you do, you know, you vanish from the political scene. You're off the stage. And my attention was drawn to this elderly male, and he was just, I think he was trying to shoot himself or so. He was so upset. And then he asked these shooters to just shoot him too. He says, well, I don't want to live anymore. This is just too much for me. Too much. And so it would seem to be a death blow to the right, the conservative movement, what is coming. A death blow, a real severe death blow. That just knocks all hope. That any truth is going to come out, that any, you know, anything positive momentum can happen in this world, it's just going to knock it out. And people just go into despair. I see people going into despair. That's what I saw in the dream. This is a suicidal despair. I'm not going to go into despair. Not like doing Kennedy's, you know, that was bad. When I was like 7 years old or so, that was really bad. I never recovered entirely. It was terrible. Because Kennedy, I put this Kennedy's inauguration speech on one of the videos I just did on the Jesus Holy Card video as a background, because it's a very interesting juxtaposition of positivity and super positivity. So you get the difference between the two. Kennedy was some super positive person. I mean, he's just fabulous. I mean, if you listen to that speech, now I realize why people thought so highly of him. I mean, my parents' generation. When Kennedy was elected, I mean, people were just in love with Kennedy. I mean, they believed that positivity was coming to this planet like it's never been before, and we have the right guy for it. And, you know, it was Camelot. It really was. Listening to that speech, I realized, wow, you know, this guy was passionate. And he had a way with words. Of course, he had speech writers, but he could deliver a speech in a passionate way to connect with people that we haven't had. You know, Reagan was very good at it too, but Kennedy was even better. I mean, you listen to that inauguration speech, wow, he really knew how to hit the positivity buttons in people without dividing them. You know, he was a unifier. He wasn't a divider, as so many demagogues are, you know, that we're experiencing now. And he stood up to Russia. I mean, the whole speech was standing up to Russia. He says, look, this is, I'm laying on the line, this is how it's going to be. You're not messing in our hemisphere at all. The Chinese too, standing up to the communists. He was adamant. Adamant. Of course, they had the missile crisis, and he stood up to them. So he was a very potent, you know, positivist, Kennedy. So I put this speech in, as background audio for this Jesus Holy Cards, where I put quotations from A Course in Miracles in there, which are super positive, super positive. So you can see the difference between Kennedy and Jesus, and you realize it's apples and oranges. It's apples and oranges. It's completely different. Completely different. And so that's why I put it in there, so you could contrast the two. It's not a put-down of Kennedy at all. I mean, he was a very able positivist. In fact, he was so strongly that way, they got rid of him. Those who wanted the positivity to be all theirs, you know, they said, wow, this guy, you know, he's trouble. He's too popular. He may decide that he can say anything he wants to say. He was a very confident guy. Very, you don't get that kind of confidence anymore. Very, well, Trump is similar, confidence-wise. But Kennedy was smoother. You know, he had some other characteristics. He'd gone through World War II, profiles in courage, right? And so he was, you know, he had a lot of positive qualities that people really liked. He was a very, very positive figure. But of course, this is delusional and leads us away from super positivity. So you have to be able to see the difference between like a Jesus and a Kennedy. They're not the same at all. And the positivists keep trying to tell us that Jesus was just this really great positivist like Kennedy or someone, a great positive rabbi, which is exactly the opposite of truth, where Jesus was this transcendent, divine, super positivist that came to liberate us from the false religion of positivity, from the goddess worship and all of that, to liberate us from the dream. Not by saying we're outside of the dream, we've separated ourselves from the dream, but by saying that the dream is not outside of us in any way, meaning we're totally in control of dreaming and we can stop dreaming, or we can exchange this dream for a happy dream. That it's only a dream. It doesn't affect us really at all. It's a dream of time, and yet time is only in the moment. It's just a dream moment we're having, moment by moment. So Jesus came to awaken us from the dream, not to make us happy within the dream, not to adjust us within the dream, not to try and fix the dream or anything like that. That's positivism. That's duality. So Jesus was this great non-dualist. Kennedy was a great dualist. All right? So I recommend that video, Jesus Holy Card video, to get the sense of like, wow. I mean, you get the best of both, Jesus and Kennedy. I mean, Kennedy may be one of the best, you know, positivists we've ever had in this world. Churchill was another, but Kennedy was more smooth. He was handsome. He was dashing. He was like a great humanitarian, and he had all these ideals. He was a great idealist, and he expressed himself so eloquently and with so much passion and also courage. You know, and he says, you want to fight? We won't back down one iota from a fight. That kind of thing, you know? So if you want to try it, we're more than ready. And not one of us will turn our back on the challenge ahead of us. We're more than ready to take on any and all challenges, period. You know, that kind of feisty, too. He was feisty, but in an eloquent way, eloquently feisty. And wow, what a leader for the positivist, you know. Wow, they just were in absolute love with Kennedy, and still are. I mean, this has gone on. I mean, still, you know, it's died out a bit now since this newest fellow has taken up the positivist, you know, flag, banner, carrying that banner. Can't hold a candle to Kennedy, though. But that's okay. All positivists are just peddling self-delusion, non-awakening. It's an attempt to empower non-awakening is what it really is. But positivists tend to be very much thinking that they're really great. They have to have a self-confidence, right? Thinking that, hey, I'm the greatest thing ever. And they hope people will, you know, buy into that. But Kennedy was a real fighter. He really would fight for what he felt was right. I mean, he was very determined in that way. And apparently he saw something that he didn't like from the shadow government and what's called the elites, and he was determined to fight it, and that's what caused him to exit the scene. So if we exit the scene, we'll do it on our own terms, okay? This is the protection of the Dharma King. We'll do it on our own terms. We may all beings experience the absolute protection of the Dharma Kings, or the Dharma King. We can plural singular, so either way it's fine, because all one mind. May all beings without exception experience absolute protection. Now keep in mind, think about this. And also may they all be absolutely invulnerable. Now, if you're a dualist, you won't pray this way. You won't affirm this way because you say, well, you say, I don't want my enemy to be invulnerable. I want him to be vulnerable so I can get rid of him. Okay, that's how they think. I don't want them to be protected. I want them to be not protected. I want me to be protected, them not to be protected. I want to wipe them out so I don't have to deal with them anymore. This is duality. This is the wrong way to pray. It makes things worse for you. The right way to pray is to say, look, if everyone's invulnerable, that means I am too. So no, I can't have enemies. If everyone's invulnerable, how can anyone have enemies? Think about that. And this is what Jesus tells us and harps on this very crucially. He says, look, if everybody's invulnerable, how can there be any enemies? Nobody can harm anyone else. So nobody can come to me and harm me in any way. So how can they be my enemy? How could there be guilt? How could there be fear? Right? This thing keeps going to black, and it comes out of it. Okay, what are we, 2:10 already? Oh, the same thing with protection. If everybody's perfectly protected, how could anyone harm me? I'm protected too. They're protected for me, I'm protected for them. Wonderful. Isn't that great? So this is the perspective shift into super positivity that Jesus has been working with us on. As well as the other Dharma kings and queens throughout history, is the shift into super positivity of seeing this perspective. Say, hey, wait a minute. Why do I have to keep dreaming a dream of enemies? Because if we're all one, if they're vulnerable, I am vulnerable too. If vulnerability exists for any of us, it exists for all of us. If vulnerability does not exist for any of us, it doesn't exist for any of us. All of us. It doesn't exist for all of us. So, the way to affirm truth is to say, you know, may all beings be invulnerable. Because you're saying that if anyone's invulnerable, we all are. See? So we might as well state it that way, that we're all invulnerable. May all beings be invulnerable. Without exception, without any exception whatsoever. And may that all be true right now, this instant right here. May I realize it, this very instant. This is very important. Because really in a dream, all dreaming is taking place each instant. So if you want to have a happy dream, you have to stress the fact you're seeing this right now. And yes, it may seem to extend in time, space, process, form a little bit, this thing. That's fine. This is the illusion. It's still an illusion. But it's extending from now. Okay? The now is seems to extend itself. The now seems to extend itself like that. So we're not gradualist. We're saying we want to see this is true this instant. Without any effort on our part, that it's instantaneously sudden enlightenment, instantaneously so. Uncaused, we say. LOngchenpa uses the term uncaused, meaning it's instant. It's not like, okay, this has been caused, but something caused it before, prior. No, this is the prior. This is prior. This is prior to all, anything we can dream of. It's prior to anything we can dream of. May this instant reveal the perfect invulnerability of all, and the perfect stability of all, and the perfect freedom of all. So this is the priorness, okay? Because our mind tends to work in causality of priorness. So we need to affirm that this realization is the priorness to whatever it is we can imagine it could be caused. It is the priorness. We're experiencing the causation. I did manage to get some sleep. Once I managed to finally get my head down on the pillow, that was brutally difficult. Then I was able to sleep, so that's good. I feel okay. more or less. So we've covered a lot of territory. We've taken quite a hike here, haven't we? Days are getting nice now. We're going to have like 4 beautiful days. I'll probably just have to be sitting in the room. Now, I present videos. There's a reason why I present what I do. Is to help smooth out your resistances. For instance, the whole Eucharist thing. There's a lot of resistance. People have resistance to seeing it, what it's really about. We're not attacking anything. I greatly respect and honor all the efforts we've made to find happiness, right? The fact that it was based on a false premise doesn't mean it wasn't creative, doesn't mean it wasn't heartfelt, doesn't mean it wasn't sincere, all this stuff. So, they're appealing to the Holy Spirit, you know, is very important. Help, help, appealing to God for help. All of that has elements, you know, of greatness in it. And there was a lot of creativity and beauty put into it also. We always tend to beautify everything. So there's a lot of holy cards that are very beautiful and touching and wonderful. And so presenting these is a way of saying, okay, I can see how this was based on magical belief. Okay, fine. I can see what truth is now also, but I'm also honoring my creativity. It's a very important aspect of what we do. We do honor our creativity. We don't attack the past. We honor the past because it was very creative. And we worked hard. We worked hard at all this stuff. So we don't have a hostile attitude towards the past and towards Christianity, Catholicism. Not at all. Just the opposite. We have a lot of positive feelings towards it. But we do want to correct the mistakes also. So, from our standpoint, it doesn't do to just throw out the baby with the bathwater. We honor ourselves, what we are. We're the holy sons of God with this awesome, perfect creativity. And so, whatever we are involved with, it's sacred. You know, even though it may be a whimsical dream, it's still sacred. It's a sacred, whimsical dream. So, the idea of this divinity and sacredness, the appealing to God, all of this, That's there in Christianity and in these holy cards. You can feel that people really went to great efforts. You know, the lace work that they did for these holy cards and just extraordinary work that they did. People were feeling like in great prayerful, you know, very prayerful. Of course, they're praying to be protected from catastrophe. Ultimately, deep down, the wrath of God, which is, you know, is delusional. However, they want to awaken from their nightmare. Okay, they just don't know how to do it, and so they're trying, and so we're honoring the trying of everyone to awaken from their nightmare. And I look at the holy cards and I'm touched by them, you know, really. And I try to get positivity out of it. And you can do that. You can feel, you know, I don't want anyone to feel, you know, negativity. So I put these holy cards in these extraordinarily beautiful frames, flower frames, various frames, and I put quotes from A Course in Miracles just to remind you of the truth, really. But this is it's helpful. I mean, it's helped me awaken to flip the whole script. And by looking at this, at some point, you may feel so benevolent in your own mind, you could realize, I can flip the script without getting really angry. And that's important. You don't want to get really angry. If you see this as all a grand deception, you might feel, I'm going to be furious about it. But no, I wasn't furious at all. I just said, oh, that's useful. Okay, great. I see that. So I try to have very positive feelings towards beauty. Everything that's been invested in beauty, I tend to have a very positive feeling towards it, and so I don't get angry at people. Very seldom do I get angry at people. I might be shocked by their attitudes and stuff, but I don't get really angry. They're engaged with beauty. Are we not all engaged with beauty? Everybody's attracted to beauty, right, in some form. Are we not? Whatever it may be. So there's a longing in everyone for truth, to awaken from this nightmare. And so I love and respect that in everyone, because that reminds me of my own longing too. It helps remind me. There was this sort of a demo, some sort of day at a place that they had all this food, big old gathering of stuff. You know, it was like a, you know, sale, big sale, free food for everyone. It was a big thing. I was there. And so they were having tacos, and I said, well, I'm a vegetarian, so I can't have anything, and I don't know. And then I said, well, I'm not going to just blow these people off just because, you know. I said, maybe I just go get a taco and some shred. And I went over and looked, and they had shredded cheese and lettuce and salsa and macaroni salad, all this stuff. I said, well, hey. So I just went up to the lady that was serving the meat on the taco, and I said, look, I'm a vegetarian. Can you give me a veggie taco? She said, sure, absolutely. And she was delighted that I'd come over and gotten food from them, you know? She really was. I thought they'd kind of be like, reject me, because I was rejecting all their good meat, chicken, and the beef, and the various pork. They had all the shredded stuff for the taco. But she wasn't. She was like delighted. She goes, oh, you came over anyway for the taco and the veggie. She says, of course we have delicious veggie tacos for you. All the stuff over there you can put on your taco and enjoy it. I was like, wow. So I went over there, I filled my plate up, I had a fabulous meal. Fabulous meal. So it's kind of like that. It's like, yeah, I'm aware of the mistakes of Christianity, but at the same time, you know, I'm not going to have that meat, you know, the self-deception of it. But the beauty of it, yeah, I'm still going to have the beauty of it, and the heartfeltness of it, and the longing of it, and the Jesus of it, and the, you know, God and Holy Spirit of it. I'm going to have all the good stuff of it too. I'm just not going to, you know, eat the red meat, the dead animals. I'm just not going to eat the dead animals part of it, the sacrificial part of it and this stuff. But I understand now why that you know, we're using it to try to prevent this terrible catastrophe. So, I mean, their heart was in the right place. So, maybe that taco experience was a lady showing me, look, you know, and same thing with the Virgin Mary. I mean, it's an attempt to avoid catastrophe also, and to try and stabilize the atmosphere. In Christianity, you see, there's two different things. There's a Virgin Mary thing in Christianity, and then there's the yoga girl thing of goddess worship. They're different. They're kind of different. Christianity was more designed to worship the passivity of the sky and atmosphere, and hoping that will protect us. It was mostly that. And so the context of that is different. Whereas the yoga girl thing is more materiality, sex, drugs, rock and roll, materiality thing. They're really into what they're feeling is they feel there's this doom coming, and they say, well, what do we do about this growing fear and agitation? Well, sex, drugs, rock and roll, materiality, party, you know, it's like the goddess giving you a good time, the mother saying, giving you treats and trying to keep you. That's what they're really into. That's what they're really into. You know, let's all party, let's all, but give it a spiritual spin to it all. But if you look at the iconography of Christianity with the Virgin Mary back through history, the way it was presented is this very gentle, benign, calm, pacific, like a mother shielding the child. The child represented this world, Jesus represented the world, the Virgin Mary represents space, but especially the atmosphere of the planet, magnetosphere, the whole protection of this planet from the cosmos. So they're saying that we have this very nurturing, protecting planet, protecting us from problems. Now, as part of this is spilled over into the New World Order, yoga girl, communistic sort of thing. But they're more arrogant in thinking that they're going to be in charge of this New World Order, that you know, and materiality and all that stuff. So it's not the same. It's different flavors of goddess worship. Christians really didn't worship the goddess the way it's being worshipped now. Not so much. Okay, it was a particular way of, again, trying to get rid of the fear and believing the future is going to be this paradise. Okay, so I can see, you know, there is different flavors. Very different. One's vanilla, one's chocolate, so to speak. I mean, they're very different flavors. And they did not put it above Jesus back then, no. But they certainly enjoyed that icon because it gives a sense of, you know, the world being protective and nurturing, like a mother, whereas Jesus is more to do with this appeasing God, keeping the wrath of God away from us, which is a little more abstract. See, so you can understand how it works this way. So there's a lot of holy cards with the Virgin Mary. I didn't post any of those, I don't think, but I have a lot of them. I might post them. I don't know. Maybe it'll help, maybe it won't, I don't know. But maybe you'll be able to get the difference. You feel, wait a minute, this is different than this whole goddess yoga, this yoga girl thing in the world right now. It's very arrogant, very aggressive. My God, I showed up at this house, and this yoga girl was there, the owner of the house, and she looked at me. I had some work to do there. She looked at me like a real hostile stare. She goes, what are you doing here? What are you doing here? I didn't ask you to come here. It's like, get out of here. Get out of my face. If I want you to come, I'll tell you to come. This is the yoga girl thing. I mean, it is nasty. The yoga girls are very nasty in terms of their arrogance. They're basically saying, we're the ones who are going to be running things in the future, period. And you're going to do what we say. And that's all there is to it. Basically, what they're saying is, you failed to protect us from Nibiru. Now, once we reconstitute this world, we're going to make the decisions of how to protect ourselves from Nibiru, okay? Not you. You don't have anything more to do with it. All you're praying to Jesus didn't work. So they're pissed off. They're angry. They're really angry because I think they feel deep down it didn't work. And so they're saying, no, we're gonna pray to the goddess. We're gonna decide how it's done because you guys don't know how to get it done. Well, guess what? They don't either. They don't either at all. There isn't any way to get it done. Now, the ancients put pyramids all over the planet to try and stabilize the magnetics and the earthquakes, etc. They worked at it in a high technology way, apparently with extraterrestrials, Anunnaki, who was a cosmic consortium, cosmic corporate consortium culture, who is an earthquake culture. I mean, that's what I mean. Pyramid culture to stabilize the planets who are disturbed cosmically. They put earthquakes at strategic places, have this machinery in the pyramids, to which they removed. It's not there anymore, but it helps stabilize the planet when this Nibiru passes, and various troubles. It's a stability thing. So they tried to engineer a lot of stability into this planet. And there was various wars and stuff, as usually, what happens here. So, the idea is that the yoga girls are saying that humans have destabilized the planet. That we're the cause of it. And so we can control that catastrophe by just having this super strong regulation. So they're denying Nibiru and claiming it's all human-made. All troubles are simply made by humans. And that all our praying to Jesus was just a mythical nonsense. So I guess you might say they're Planet X deniers. And then where do you go for it? You go towards humanism, that we're the humans are the cause of all troubles in the cosmos. And by regulating humans, we will avoid all trouble. And they know how to, regulate. Big Mother knows how to regulate, like turn us all into little children. And they're going to just say no. And they say no to a child. The child's all scared. Oh, okay, Mom, I better not do it. That's the kind of relationship they want to establish, is this bureaucracy, a very intimidating bureaucracy that just, if it shouts at you, you freeze. And this is what this yoga girl did when we had this little fender bender thing. It was so minor, it's unbelievable. And she just was shouting at me like a mother shouting to a child. And she really tried to infantize me. There's no question about it. And she was brutal at it. I mean, she wouldn't quit. She would not quit. I finally just left the scene. That's why I just left. I didn't leave the scene of the accident. I just went into this building nearby and just hung out with friends there because she was trying to infantize me, shouting at me like I was a little child, trying to intimidate me the way the mother would intimidate a little child. You know how they do it. The mom just screams at the child and the child's just shocked. And then it's okay, Mom shouted at me. What does she want me to do? This is what this lady was doing to me. And she wouldn't quit. She would not quit. I just said, no. Wait a minute, calm down. No. You do what I tell you to do. You are doing what I tell you to do. You do what I'm telling you to do, like I'm a child. And I say, I'm not a child. I'm nobody's child. You're not going to tell me what to do. You want the police to come? Great, because they'll treat us equally. All right? And they'll sort it out as an adult. They'll be the adult in the room. They were. The police did that. Great job. But so this is the yoga girl thing. What they're after is to create this bifurcation here of this all-powerful bureaucracy, which, of course, they run. because it's Big Mother, and then this intimidated, childlike, infant, you know, childlike, childish-like, juvenile-like population of the world, who simply, like zombies, whatever Mother tells them to do, they do. And they think by doing this, we will iron out the problems of humanity and have no more catastrophes on this planet. Completely overlooking the periodicity of Nibiru, right? And many other things that happen in the cosmos, actually, that are constantly changing everything and subjecting everything to all sorts of troubles and stresses and strains. No, it's all anthropocentric, completely anthropocentric, which is the opposite. You know, it's saying, instead of waking up and saying, no, this is all spiritual-based dream, that we just, this is a dream of spirit, they're saying, no, this is the work of humanity, and that we have corrupted everything here on the planet, and that's what's causing all the troubles. It's causing some, but not the big one, not the real big trouble. Actually, it's not causing any real troubles because it's all a dream. So look out for this. I mean, that's why I stay away from these yoga girls. They are trying to infantize us. And it's like Steph Curry, you know, he's going to be the MVP again. I mean, he's like one of the greatest basketball players that ever stepped on a court anywhere in the world at any time, whether it's a YMC game, a pickup game, out in the playground, some in China, in Spain, Yugoslavia, anywhere in the world, throughout the entire history of anybody who's ever walked on a basketball court and dribbled a basketball. Steph Curry is one of the best players to ever step on a basketball court. There's a few others too, like Michael Jordan was one of them, but he is in that echelon. And so it's the end of the game, after breaking the record, for this yoga girl to grab him and basically infantize him, you know, basically infantize him, sort of eroticize him, infantize him, the whole ball of wax, you know. And everybody looking at that is in a super emotional state. And then they get pulled down into this relationship with this yoga girl, thinking, this is the way I need to relate to her. You know, she asks these simple kind of like mom, it's like mom talking to a child. Like, so Steph, you know, how do you think of that? Like, he's like a kind of a juvenile. You know, where someone else would handle a very different situation. They treat him like a man, you know. Like a, you know, man of accomplishment, of grace and dignity and a lot of stuff. And it would be a completely different feel to it. The yoga girls give a totally different spin to all this emotionalism that arises. When they get the attention, there's super amount of attention, emotional attention. They gravitate to situations to have emotional attention, like a mother-child thing. And then get the people used to them being in charge. This is why they're using sports for that purpose. So I'm boycotting sports because I realized how detrimental it is now to us. So detrimental. They've completely invaded it. They've discovered this gold mine of how to control people. They're infantizing us, plain and simple. They're trying to infantize us. Doing a good job of it too. Very good job. Most people are now never get beyond a juvenile state of mind right now in this world. That's a fact. It's a fact. You want to meet adults, you need to go back in time almost, you know, back to our ancestors, where there are a lot of adults around, actually. And nowadays, you have mostly juveniles. If you meet an adult, it's like, oh my gosh, I thought we were extinct, you know? It's like amazing. You have someone who has a mature adult perspective, it's just like shocking. It really is. You say, oh, it's like a breath of fresh air. So really? You still exist? And mostly older people. I said, we're dying off. They say, I know. I mean, you actually have some comments, adults, cult. You can treat people like an adult. Yeah, oh, wow. It's amazing. These yoga girls don't treat you like an adult at all. You don't feel you're dealing with an adult. You're dealing with someone who's viewing you as a child, and they're the mother. That's not adult at all. They refuse to interact that way. So I refuse to interact with them because the dichotomy they're putting me in, trying to put me in, the box, I don't want to be put in that box. And they refuse to be an adult and a spiritual meeting of the mind. They refuse. So there's no opportunity for me there. It's only lose for me. You know, and they have so much power now, and legal power, all sorts of power, that you feel very intimidated, and you feel like you need to then get into this role, because if you don't, they'll claim that you're harassing them, you're, you know, whatever, because they refuse to have an adult relationship. They claim that anything that adults can handle that is harassing them, making them feel uncomfortable, because in their idealized image of themselves, they're all powerful mother, that everyone obeys them. So if you don't agree with them, they think that you're harassing them or something. I mean, it's just, it's insane what has happened. You can't talk back to them and say, you say, no, that's not right. They take great offense at that. Just like a mother would take great offense at a child sassing them and say, don't sass me back. So they view us as children, and I'm not a child. You know, I refuse to be put into that perspective. I'm a spiritual child, but I'm a spiritual free spirit beyond anything that can even be imagined as a child. Jesus uses the term child. I don't quite like that term because it plays too much in with this infantization that's taking place in this world. But he uses it in such a way that I understand what he's getting at, is when you're a child, you feel free to imagine anything you want to imagine. Right? And you feel, it's this feeling that you have when you're a child is what he's getting at. But certainly he's not telling you that you're a child vis-a-vis a mother who's controlling you. That is, no, he's saying you're a child and you're absolutely free. You know, you're not caught up in this, all this nonsense. The way when we felt when we were children, we didn't identify with the body so much, is what he's getting at. We didn't identify with the false self, the body, time, space, processor form. We felt like, children think like, I can imagine it, it's true for them, right? And nothing, you know, the children, when they're playing, they'll look at something and say, okay, this is now a tree. We're going to play a game. Okay, this is a tree. This is the lake is here. This is this. And so they just create this landscape, and that stuff, that's what it is for them. And the adult says, no, that's a tree, you know, that's, or this is a post, it's not a tree. And this is a puddle, it's not a lake. And come on. But the kids, in order to play a game, they just say, okay, how do we need to imagine what this is, what, and for them, this is what they see, this is what they experience. It's amazing. You hear the kids say, okay, let's play. And they can play nonstop all day. And it's just a constant stream of creativity of imagining what they want to experience. And they don't, you know, the world to them doesn't dictate to them what is their experience. Nature doesn't dictate to them. They just decide what they're seeing, what they're perceiving, what they're experiencing is. And that's what it is. That's what Jesus is getting at. All right, so holy cards, possible. I could work on that. Some I could involve, some time I could do this, you know, and put it out. And it may be helpful. If it's not, fine. I'm not trying to make some big statement. I'm just saying this might be helpful because we do need to have a proper, healthy perspective on the world, on the religions of the world, the various traditions and things like that, and understand, put it in the right context, which humanity has a catastrophic history. There's no question about it. We're very, very paranoid, frightened of what's up in the sky, what might be coming. That's why the ancient people studied the skies. So they said, how can we tell when the trouble is coming? How can we, you know, prepare for it? They tried to figure out, you know, what could be coming at us. I mean, meteors, you know, asteroids hit the planet. There's various gravity waves hit the planet. There's various, the sun, coronal mass ejections, you know, hit the planet. There's a whole host of space weather that affects the planet. And so they tried to figure out when it would happen and what kind of sacrifice they could make to prevent it from happening. So it was all tied up, astronomy was tied up with sacrifice, ritual, all this stuff, trying to control what happened in the heavens. That's our heritage. It really is. In terms of this dream goes, dream heritage, you might say. How are we doing here? We're just cooking along. Oh, this one could go a long time. I've discovered the key to longevity, folks. I really have. Ouch. My neck is really... It's been bothering me. First the left grab has been grabbing for a long time, and then suddenly the right grab. Now the left is fine. It's the right that's problem. So I certainly see something about politically, if you want to look at it that way, that it's the right that's going to be really severely undermined and demolished, it looks like. And the people have nowhere to go. They'll just really be in despair. And the left is going to win the day, of course. They have, you know, all the institutions are all aligned. There's all alignment there. Their magical belief. They say, my magical belief is stronger than your magical belief. And so, we win. But there's no winning. There's just awakening. There's no winning. There's just awakening. There's no winning. There's just awakening. May all beings experience perfect freedom and no loss. May all beings realize they can never lose. And they can never lose. Nobody can ever lose. I could never lose any experience I want. It's impossible for me to lose it. No one, may all beings recognize that loss is impossible for anyone. Loss is totally impossible anywhere, anyone, for anyone. May all beings have this realization right now, without another instant passing. Let this be prior to any instant passing. Let this realization be the priorness. So let us abide in this priorness to any imagined causation. Okay? Wow, I like that a lot. I feel a shift when I say that. Like I'm in some sort of different mental space. Yeah. Priorness. If we posit causality to truth, then when there's duality, then we need to practice saying, well, I'm prior to the causality. Now, it may feel like a slightly strange state to be in, but it's a blissful state, I would say. And it's certainly a steady state. Prior to all causality, it'd be very steady, wouldn't it? So let the mind abide in that. It's Ramana Maharshi, let the mind abide in that. You see how steady and calm he was. Steady, it was absolutely steady, absolutely calm. Wow. I need this neck to free up. I think it's just helping me working through the reactions to what's coming up. I believe there's likely to be some major troubles coming up politically, endangerments, major loss on the right. The right may go through some very severe setbacks. This is just, you know, how it is. So we're prior to all causality here. We're abiding in that super positivity. It's so super positive, no causality can attack it or affect it in any way at all. That's how positive it is. Super positive. Whereas positivity is still in this duality of what they would say causality, and they're just trying to work on causality to try to bring about better positivity. Okay? I don't think I can lean back here. You see, the neck suddenly lacks stability there. Beauty is important. We don't want the yoga girls to corner the market on beauty. They're trying to do that, superficial beauty. So I make some very beautiful videos. I always recognize aesthetics, honor aesthetics. It's our creativity. We can't just hand over the whole thing to the yoga girls and let them have that entire sphere of attraction to beauty and let them use it for their own nefarious purposes. At least this is how I see it. I mean, ultimately, if you're a great meditator, you can see within the ineffableness of reality within, and the any external beauty isn't really attractive at all. I mean, that is true also. So it's a fine line. I'm not exactly sure how to walk this line. But I don't want anyone thinking, well, we got to go to the yoga girls for some good music and some beauty and all this kind of stuff. Because that's a disaster. You can go here and get the super positivity along with the beautiful music, along with the beautiful graphics, okay? I'm finding some really beautiful music, very appropriate stuff. I thank all the musicians that have done that. Somehow I'm able to match up the music to some extent. As good as well as I can. I mean, I could certainly imagine something better, but why should I? These people are experts. They're doing a pretty good job, and I'm finding it. They're making it available, so we thank them for that. I'm not going to waste my time as I did before trying to develop some better music for these times, which I did. I tried to, but it was. I couldn't quite push it through. I realized I'm trying to do too much. I need to focus on other stuff. So again, you know, it's not perfect, but it's not bad either. It's something, at least it's some, you know, little flavor of aesthetics of beauty. We're not trying to be iconoclastic here when it comes to beauty. We certainly do not... We do not emphasize the human form in terms of beauty. We do not use the human form as far as beauty goes. We will have that the Dharma kings may be in a frame of flowers or such, but that's it. We're not, you know, so I try to be very careful about that. Occasionally a human form will be used. I remember one frame has a swan and a lady there, but she looks like she's having a nightmare, and it's a spiritual thing about her wanting to wake up to truth. So I left that in. I wasn't trying to glamorize her. I felt I wasn't trying to glamorize the body. So I'm very careful not to associate beauty with the human body. It's very important. Islam is very careful about that. I applaud their you know, their diligence about that. It's very important. It's very important not to associate beauty with the human body. Extremely important. That really pulls us into positivity and away from super positivity. It's one of the worst things to do. So Christianity would just use beauty for the saints. They said that don't use it. So that's understandable too. they had the context. They understood the context that only the saints were depicted in a positive. The common people were not beautified. Were not depicted in a aesthetic, beautifully way. And they tried to limit it to just the saints. Then Islam went further and said nobody at all. And I try to limit it severely. I present Jesus just in a humble garb of like just a tunic or something. I try to do that. But I'm presenting of the flowers is the truth. You know, we're glorifying the truth. Beauty should be used to glorify the truth of super positivity. So we might have a statement of words or something, statement of the truth, glorified by a beautiful frame around that. Or a humble Jesus or a humble LoNgChenpa, for instance, a humble Sri Sri Anandamayi, humble Ramaharshi, with a beautiful frame glorifying their perfect realization of super positivity. Abiding in this priorness to any causality. Simply the isness. So I'm very, very careful about that. You know, if a state crops up here and there, then just disregard it. I found these beautiful frames. I mean, good God, it just knocked me out. I asked Jesus, the Holy Spirit, for some help, LoNgChenpa, and the Holy Spirit delivered. I really wanted it, and I had this experience of putting these slides together. And it's like a dream come true. It's a bucket list thing. My whole life, I've tried to find some really beautiful frames to frame truth in, and I've never been able to find it. And so I was thinking, how do I frame these holy cards? I came across this website. I was able to do it. They have just gorgeous frames. The alpha channel is just perfect the way it is, just extraordinary. It's like, oh, it's like dream come true. My gosh. The trouble, flip side of it is, it could be misused. Very much usually is, probably. I just gave it the right usage. But usually these frames are used to put, usually women, glamorous women, to have these frames around them to attract you to their body. A body which is really attracting us to our own death. It is, as Jesus tells us, both pleasure and pain equally attract us to death. He said that the idea of death of the body. The body is a chosen instrument of the sacrificial dream. So that's a very negative way to use any sort of glamour beauty to surround women or men in a glamorous way like that. Only the great Dharma kings and that should be presented in that fashion. Not ourselves, not other people, should not be presented in that fashion. This is very strict. I mean, this is very important. The great saints are presented with flower, like framed flowers are put on their frame, all this stuff, decoration of beauty are put there. Sometimes teachers have flowers and stuff, but the Dharma prince should not have a lot of flowers, in my opinion, or should not be framed in that way. Dharma princess should not be framed in that way. They should just be like ordinary, you know, pictures. Just keep it ordinary. There might be some little thing, I don't know exactly, but there's a big difference between a Dharma prince and a Dharma king. Big difference. The Dharma prince somehow conveys, what they convey is so powerful that beauty can be attached to them without losing the message. Some aesthetics can be attached to them without losing the message. Not so with others, not so with the Dharma prince or princess. They're still very much in the world and subject to being attracted to the body, believing in the body, all of that is still, the potentiality is still there for sure. So they have to guard against that also, just like we all do. Noisy day, huh? Well, because it's a Friday. 250 or something? I don't know. What is that? Maybe it's 250 and we're already up. Oh, yeah. Wow. And music, too, should be abstract. It should not be, for the most part, should not be this pop music. It's terrible. Pop music's awful. Tool of the devil. It really is. It's catchy. It's beautiful. It's aesthetic. But it is so much wrapped up into goddess worship and body worship. It's just unbelievable. Wow, I wondered, wow, do we listen to this stuff? Yeah, because it was catchy, it was beautiful, it was nice musicianship, but the message is awful, awful of pop music. Some of it, you know, is better, might have some a little better, but most of it is just terrible. Good grief, it's juvenile, very juvenile. Sort of putting the juvenile on a throne and just. Where they're just obsessed with the body, and all beauty is attached to bodies. And you know, we go through that phase, but it's important to recognize it's harmful. It's very bad, and we need to minimize it and be disciplined away from that as much as possible. It's easy to get attracted back to it, and you know, this times it's always difficult. I say these yoga girl times is terrible, but there have been yoga girls throughout history. It's always yoga girl time. I mean, look at Victorian's time, like Tissot, the French painter, went to England, London, and painting all these demimondes, you know, these courtesans who are mistresses of these very wealthy industrialists, bourgeois industrialists, etc. And you know, they just dressed up in the most extraordinarily beautiful clothing and applied the jewelry and all sorts of adornment and fashion to themselves and body language and everything. I mean, they were yoga girls of that time with immense power over these men. Really, they were. They're a very powerful segment of society. I mean, powerful, wealthy men throughout history have had many mistresses, and the mistresses have more power over them than the wives, usually. And what the mistress says, or the wife, you know, we go, pretty much goes, not always, but they can very, very clever at influencing. So those were the yoga girls of those time, and I'm sure if you're living back then, you'll see these demimonds, these courtesans, mistresses, I mean, the way they're dressed, the riches, the finery, their attitudes, you know, everything, is like, you'd just be like, wow, you know, here's someone really special, very attractive, and they, you know, that then that they were used in modern advertising. These courtesan mistresses, wealthy mistresses, were used in modern advertising. That motif, you know, the Gibson girl, these wealthy aristocratic women, that became modern advertising, which is now just so incredibly wicked. And they just are obsessed with using women to popularize materialism. Of course, it's mother giving the child treats. So we want to deify, the woman, the mother. She's so beautiful. She's so attractive. I can't take my eyes off. She's everything. She's the center of my universe. There's a child. It's childish. And we try to overlook all the hideous flaws of the egotism, that they have, the arrogance and paranoia of their egotism. Like, let's not let that get in the way of us being attracted to all this materiality, That's like as if that's our salvation. I was part of certainly the 19th century Victorian era in Vienna. There's no more stronger demi-world, the demi-monde world than Vienna. I mean, London also, Paris, London, Vienna, these places. So I was very aware of all this. And, it was high society, just had all these very attractive women putting on this, ultimate show. Attracting these powerful men through just their attractiveness and trying to give them a laugh and delight, and make them think that, oh, I have this beautiful possession, this treasure. They're extremely clever at it. It's a profession. They're experts at what they do. Don't underestimate the yoga girls and the influence they have. They've always had massive influence in this world. Massive. Don't underestimate it now, especially with advertising and media and everything. They are the most, could be said, the most powerful block in the world right now. And they're feeling it. I mean, the Bible talks about the end times, the whores of Babylon. They call this Demimonde. They call the yoga girls back then, they were called the whores of Babylon. And how they would be drunk on the blood of the saints, that they would be ruling things, viciously ruling things in the end times. And we're right there. I mean, this is what's happening, actually. I mean, they're the bully on the block, to say the least. So I just stay away from them. Try to stay humble, try to stay away from them. They're bad news. Again, they will try to infantize you, and they have the law behind them entirely right now. I mean, this yoga girl, when I wouldn't infantize with, submit to her, she immediately then turned to the law and said, well, I'm going to put the law on you then, and thinking that the law would do exactly what she wanted it to do. And she was quite shocked that the police lady wouldn't take any of that from her. The police lady was not a yoga girl. She was a traditional woman. And she said, you're not going to tell me what to do. Who do you think you are? And the yoga girl was just shocked. Shocked by this, like, what? Because she thinks the law is just going to, totally back her up. This was her expectation, that the law would totally back her up. And I was kind of nervous about it too, because the way she was intimidating me is like, well, for sure the law's on my side, which in general is absolutely true. So when she says, play infant to me and submit, I'm your mother, you're an infant, you do what I tell you, you better do it. Going forward, the law is going to, you're going to get hell from the law, for sure. This is what they expect. This is how it's been set up. So keep your distance from that. Stay away from it. Somehow be somewhere where you're not subjected to that. I don't know how that's possible. It's infected. All segments of society are drastically affected by it. I don't know if there's any younger women who are not severely affected by it. It would be almost impossible not to be. It's so enculturated now. It's like water to a fish. Be a rare thing. Almost all women have a sense of entitlement now, one way or the other, some way. It's a reaction to the fear they're feeling. They feel they're entitled to continue the race here. They're entitled to have things good. They're trying to use their entitlement on men and on the world in general to as a way to beat, you know, push back the fear of Nibiru coming in. They're saying, no, I'm in charge. You know, we're going to have, everything is going to be fine here. I'm going to be happy and wealthy, and my children are going to be great. And everyone's, you know, they're trying to like enforce, as if, you know, they can enforce peace in this world. And they don't want the men being negative, and they can't, don't be negative. Let's all, you know, let's keep on this nice materialistic track we're on. Everything's going to be fine. But whereas a lot of men are saying, oh, wait a minute, the facts show us that, don't worry about the facts. Your mother's here, and I'm the one who's established what facts are for you. You're the child. I'm the adult. I determine what the rules are, what the facts are. And we're hoping this magically will mean, well, I can determine what the rules are of, you know, cosmology. I can just set, okay, Nibiru's not coming in because mommy says so, you know. That. And we're hoping maybe that will work. It's a desperate last gasp strategy. Now, when does Nibiru come in? Don't know for sure. And what the effects will be, don't know for sure. The Holy Spirit has been indicating it's imminent and it's going to be very bad. So this is many, many synchronicitous experiences I've been having without asking for them, all pointing in that same direction. So I'm just like, well, what am I supposed to think? The Bible says it's going to be terrible. Everything, much of what the Bible has predicted has come true, and it's coming true. The society, the way it's changed. By the way, they think that this dwarf twin star, this brown dwarf star, they discovered this large planetary body way, 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 way out there. Guess how many miles out there? They 66. Something they call it. It's the measurement of the sun to the earth as one unit. And so this is like 66 million units, 66 of those units or something like that. Anyway, Mark of the Beast, 66, interesting. Is the beast, this binary brown dwarf, and the effects that this has on us, thinking that it sends in Nibiru? It's pretty amazing. I saw that. They estimate the distance as 66 something. It's like, huh. Or the tormentor, you know, Satan, the great tormentor of humanity. Lucifer, you know, this idea this planet comes in, and they've named it all sorts of different names, this hideous, you know, hideous monster that punishes us and causes us such great affliction. And that we, you know, we hope that, you know, Jesus can save us from Satan, you know, if we just do the sacrifice and the Eucharist and all this kind of stuff. We're hoping that this terrible negative influence doesn't come back on our solar system. And, you know, planet Nibiru deniers say, no, it's all just humans. The whole thing's just human. And we're crazy. And that then, therefore, the way to go is this bureaucracy and control system, which technology companies are set to earn untold trillions on. Carbon tax credits. I mean, just an entire massive wealth grabbing potential here in the world of haves and have-nots. And the yoga girls are aligning themselves with the haves, as of course they always do. And they want them to win, so they get all the money and all the materialistic goods. They think that'll calm them down. But if Nibiru really does exist, it's not going to calm them down. They're going to get more and more agitated, more and more severe, more and more iron fist with a velvet glove on it, maybe. This is what's coming is trouble as we try to defend against our fear. And people say, well, don't fearmonger, don't talk about it. That makes it. Well, it's within people's minds already that they're feeling this inner concern, and the Holy Spirit keeps bringing this up. We keep bumping in. I mean, I bumped in this guy who brings up Planet X to me, says it's super important, you pay attention to this. I didn't ask for that. So something, consciousness, is aware of this and keeps impressing it, like some trouble. So you know, you say don't talk about it. What is that? That's head in the sand nonsense. We need to talk about it in an intelligent way, in a calm, compassionate way. And, you know, calm down our fears by looking at real remedies instead of pseudo, you know, magical remedies that don't work. that just makes things worse in the long run. When things get, when the, you know, when the time gets close, and we realize it didn't work, then people could really lose their faith and go pell-mell into some other type of magic, you know, go into the yoga girl thing, think that that's the answer, and then get stuck in a long cycle again of trying to work on that. Another 3,600-year cycle, a long cycle of believing that this is the answer when it turns out it's not. It's not either. It's not either. Neither magic doesn't do the trick. Grace, awakening from the dream, does the trick. And that's what the grace of God is helping us towards, without sticking our head in the sand and without saying, oh no, this, the dream we have here is not, no conflict in it. Oh, it's all based on sacrifice, fear, and conflict. Of winning and losing, of destroying, of death. It's a death-based dream. Fear-based, death-based, sacrifice-based. Of course it's full of that stuff. And as long as we don't awaken from the dream, don't have that as our purpose, we will continue to suffer from this, no matter how much we follow the yoga girls, no, how much sacrifice we do, how much ritual, how much magic, how much religion, all this kind of stuff. Same old, same old, same old. I'll tell you, when I tipped my head back and that my neck suddenly spasmed up, and I felt like I was being assassinated. I really did. It was horrible. I'd taken a bullet in the neck or something. So this may be what's going to happen in the world. Someone's going to take a bullet in the neck. Prominent individual, or maybe several, I don't know. It was shocking. I felt that my life was over or something. It was just so bizarre. That was just last night. I didn't realize that severe pain like that could come in such a way to just lock me up. And wow. I didn't take it personal. I realized it's more, most likely pointing something out. I'm putting a big push on here. For people, because I believe something is going to happen. I believe the right is going to be severely compromised and attacked. Conservative right in America. And I feel that people are going to be truly despondent. And so I'm trying to present something beautiful. At least they could feel like, oh, I can get something out of something. I feel some sort of peace and calm and assurance here. You know, this is all I'm trying to do. Not all I'm trying to do, but it's part of what I'm trying to do, is have this stuff ready so that people can recommend to one another. You know, you might have a friend that's just really freaking out. Just say, hey, I recommend you just watch this stuff. It's very peaceful. It's very soothing. And you know, somebody sees through all this stuff here. The Dharma King sees through it. The Dharma King has Dharma princes and princesses. And there's a court of the Dharma King, meaning a context of super positivity that you can get used to this. You're welcome to get a taste of this. Come taste and see what super positivity is really about. It's not a sacrificial situation, belief system at all. It's dreaming of a priorness to dreaming. You might say it's dreaming of a priorness to dreaming causation. The causativeness we think we're seeing in a dream. See, we believe we're seeing causativeness in a dream. So this is prior to causativeness, dream causativeness. We're saying that, okay. We're prior to it, yeah. So this is a different thing. It's a different thing. So these problems that come up in the world, we're not bothered by them. We're not shaken up by them. We're prior to all dream causation here. This is what we assert. Now, ultimately, a dream doesn't have any causation at all. But as far as a remedial thing, we might say, well, we're dreaming a dream of prior to dream causation. Putting ourselves in that. We'll work on this. This is a technique of super positivity I'm seeing is very powerful. Okay, so I think that's enough here. We hit the three-minute, three-hour mark, 3 gigabyte mark. Oh, boy, if I move just the wrong way, if I do the wrong movement, that neck just absolutely tries to seize up on me. Caesar. What happened to Caesar? Yeah. He said, I'm not playing by your rules. I'm going to play by my rules. And they said, the Senate said, no, you're playing by our rules. The establishment, this was the Senate in Rome. Keep in mind, right? And then Caesar came in and tried to be emperor. And they said, no, not so fast, you know. So the establishment is the one that is, you know, deciding what takes place here. And if you get some political candidate that says, look, I'm not going to play by your rules. I'm going to play by my rules. You know, that's Caesar right there. So, my neck seizing up, it has something to do with Caesar and Solace, you know, it all. It's amazing how when you're really in tune, you're open, your awareness, consciousness, where it's like you realize that the whole play is taking place within the one mind, and you are the one mind. Okay, very great. Full stop in the wow, super positivity. Keep watching the videos. I'm slaving away, trying to do something that is just, you know, a little bit helpful, little calming. You're going to need the calm coming up. You're going to need it. Don't try to dig too deeply in all the stuff on the internet, because it is a swamp and a jungle. And it's like everybody's an elephant. And they're all grabbing different parts of the elephant and screaming that they've got it. And it'll drive you crazy. I try to stay away from it as much as possible, actually. It's just horrible. I mean, the websites I click on, none of them will load anymore. They're so full of advertising. I don't know why they're not loading. They just won't load. It's amazing. YouTube is like one of the only sites that actually loads. Actually works properly. But that's full of a bunch of, you know, a lot of silliness and people just taking some video and reposting it on as if it was something different. You know, you go get confused. It's just terrible. So stay with super positivity, beauty, aesthetics, appreciate those, appreciate them. It's important to not lose sight of that, because when you get really in despair, despondency, one of the few things you look for is beauty. I just want to see something beautiful. So don't look for beauty in bodies. It's very important. Or anything that leads to bodies, really. Try to look with beauty associated with abstraction, with the Dharma kings and queens, with super positivity, and keep it there, okay? I've tried to do that with many videos I've done. Try to keep it there. Because at some point, you may feel so stressed out, you just say, I just want some beauty. You know, I like food. I just want some good food. I just want some beautiful, I want a beautiful landscape. Just something that just make me feel peaceful, and just, you know, everything's okay. Remind me of that. And at some point, words will be so confused in our mind that words just don't seem to reach us very well. Then music can reach us. Beauty can reach us, that kind of stuff. Maybe just a nice little phrase is all I need. You know, just one phrase. I'm so stressed. One phrase. Just something I could just say, oh yeah, that helps me. So I'm working on that. I'll get to work on that. Keep working at it. Okay. Full stop in the wow. We covered massive territory here. You may be just a flipping of the script. Maybe just thinking, oh wow. You know, how do I constitute a new belief system out of this? Well, super positivity is the new belief system. And we'll keep working on that. So don't worry. Abiding in the court of the Dharma King, you come across a lot of script flipping. The whole thing flips on you. And just like, wow. But the context is super positivity. And we're able to get that. We're able to work with that. We're able to hear it here. We're not bothered by it. In fact, we welcome it. We love it. We love it. So you'll get more of that, and you'll smooth it out, and you'll get more appreciation of that. It'll be easier for you. And you'll be okay. You'll be better than okay. All right? But the alternative, wow. That's why I boycott all that stuff. For me, I realized that could pull me down, can pull anybody down, except for a Dharma King. Anyone other than a Dharma King, the world can pull you down if you give it access to you. It really can. So limit your access. Boycott as much as you can. I really advise that. And then pay attention to super positivity as much as possible. Very great, that's it for this one. Stay super positive in your context. Full stop in the wow.